On playing great defense.
Cornhuskers won the toss, defer. Michigan State will get the football to begin this interesting, compelling early season Big Ten clash. A true freshman to boot it away, Drew Brown. Younger brother of former Husker Chris Brown. A short kickoff. It's into the wind tonight. Up at the 10-yard line is R.J. Shelton. And he barrels toward the 30. So the wind is blowing, Kirk, pretty stiffly right to left. It'll be at the back of this Spartans offense.
Yeah, and Connor Cook likes that. That's the one way you want to start as a quarterback. You know, Connor Cook carrying himself very differently this year. You see the numbers, 15-2 as a starter. But what's different is he won the Big Ten championship beating Ohio State. He was the MVP. He won the Rose Bowl as a starting quarterback beating Stanford. Those two games, I think, impacted him, the confidence in the way he carries himself as he's a starting quarterback this year. And that leadership will be big tonight because they're going to face some adversity at some point.
He threw it 47 times against the Ducks. Hasn't had to throw in the other three wins. The first play is a handoff to the senior Jeremy Langford, and he stopped right at the line. Here's the Chick-fil-A impact players, Herbie.
But Jeremy Langford is where this offense really starts. Last year, he got things going right about this point in the season. They run 33 to set up the play-action game, and Tony Lippitt is as hot as any receiver in the Big Ten. Randy Gregory, number four, is a very, very athletic defensive end. They move him around. He'll apply the pressure. And Cocker on the back end, kind of a jack-of-all-trades, a safety, linebacker, play nickelback. He can do it all.
So Cook will throw it on second and 10. Has protection. Now steps up, dumps it short, deflected into traffic, and intercepted. Nebraska comes up with a turnover on the second play as Cook's pass was deflected and Randy Gregory got a piece of it.
Randy Gregory ends up coming up with the ball, Chris. What an effort here. What a great job of getting pressure. And it's really the coverage that did it. The coverage downfield ends up coming up with the play. And boy, because they didn't give up on the play, Valentine, it just goes off of his helmet in the air. And that gives you an idea. But Gregory, known as a pass rusher, that time the awareness to see the ball up in the air comes up with a big turnover for the Big Red.
And so excellent field position at the plus 30 for Tommy Armstrong on the Huskers' first series. And they give it to Amir Abdullah, a guy who's 5'9", up to 200 pounds, but a tough runner between the tackles and plenty of speed outside.
He is the key to their offense. As we said in the open, though, Tommy Armstrong is going to have to be able to make some plays tonight. He is a physical quarterback, one of their strongest workers in the weight room, and it's become his team now this year with Taylor Martinez graduated.
In the pistol formation, this is Abdullah. Tries the left side, bounces it outside, well strung out, nothing there. Taiwan Jones, the middle linebacker, made the play. It'll be third and long. And now the Chick-fil-A impact players on the other side.
Yeah, we've talked a lot about Amir Abdul already, but Kenny Bell is going to be a receiver that they're going to have to be able to rely on to make some big plays to try to slow down this attacking Michigan State defense. Twan Jones will be in the middle, very athletic, replacing Bulla in the middle at the Mike linebacker, and Curtis Drummond. They'll put him very close to the line of scrimmage. He'll be playing man-to-man and also in run support. Number 27 for the Green, very, very pivotal player in their scheme tonight.
On third and 11, Armstrong rolls, fires, near sideline, low throw, incomplete. He was looking for Alonzo Moore, but three plays, lose 1 yard. They can't cash in the turnover to 7 points. Here comes a field goal attempt.
This is just the inexperience. I think he locked on this time to the outside. Watch the route and watch how Westerkamp on third down finds an opening in that zone. He was locked into the outside, predetermined where he wanted to go with the football. If he would have read the coverage and come back to the inside, it's a first down for Nebraska.
And because of the wind, Nebraska will not even try a long field goal here. Sam Foltz is the sophomore punter. Now Garrett Kings Jr. is deep. With the win, you for sure try the field goal, but this boot out of the back of the end zone is a touchback.
I think he was anticipating a little bit more wind there. That almost cleared the end zone.
So, an early turnover for the Spartans doesn't cost him. Still scoreless. So Michigan State's offense bailed out by the defense there. Three and out in the punt after the interception. The second possession from the 20. This is Langford picking his way for a short gain. Nebraska's got a couple of 300-pound sophomores in the center of that defensive line.
Yeah, they're young, but they're very, very talented, athletic. Talk to Bo Pelini. He'll tell you quickly that the strength of his defense, he feels, is his front. He's got some depth. He's got some guys that have grown up a lot from last year where they were forced into the lineup because of some injuries. But Bo feels right now that the guys up front, led by Randy Gregory, are playing very well so far this season.
The linebacking core is thin. Two men injured tonight, Marcus Newby and David Santos. Play action on second down. Cook scrambles, fires downfield, incomplete. Just across the 40-yard line, he was looking for Aaron Burbridge.
Connor Cook remembers last year his trip to Lincoln and how Gregory gave him a lot of trouble. He put a lot of pressure on him, and he talked about that this week. And they actually try to get him to bite on the play action to get him to overcommit and then go around him. They even put a tight end on him. Even with a play fake and the tight end, he still has an impact on the play.
Gregory, a guy whose knee injury cost him the first couple of games, and he came out possessed against the Hurricanes. Third and eight. Cook straight back. Fires near side, incomplete, well defended, in and out of the hands there as Daniel Davey made the play, and another three and out.
It really looked like Davey might at the last moment got his left hand in there to separate that football. And you're talking about, look at the shakes there and how Lippitt gets separation at the top of that route, but you might not be able to see it there, but it looked like Davey never gave up on the play. And he got his left hand in there to be able to knock that football away. That was an outstanding play. And good job of not giving up on that play and knocking the ball out.
The true freshman, Demorne Pearson-El, back deep as the four-year punter. The two-time All-Big Ten punter, Mike Sadler, is on. And the lefty gets it away. On the bounce, it's fielded by Pearson-El. And now they blow it dead.
You know, I don't think he called a fair catch.
I didn't see it.
I think he was using his hands to say clear, clear, clear.
Yeah.
As telling his own players to, like, you know, a lot of times you'll hear a Peter, Peter, Peter call, but not a fair catch call. And that's why I think he was just trying to kind of separate his arms, saying, guys, get out of the way. Watch his hands. Yeah, that's a Peter, Peter, Peter call, meaning, guys, that means it's a short kick, but there's no call of a fair catch at all.
So incorrectly interpreted as a fair catch. Nebraska takes over at their 34.
Wait.
Nebraska ball for 34. Bill Nemagne, our official consultant, who is saying that because Pearson-El gave the giveaway sign, once he grabs the ball, he cannot advance it. So the Cornhuskers' second possession. This is Abdullah again hammering the line. He's a guy that comes in averaging 167 yards per game. He's had three 200-yard games in the first five of the season.
Think about that again. I mean, think about how many backs in the last 20 years of college football, especially now with the spread. How many backs have had three 200-yard games in a season? He's had it in his first five games, and the offense is built around what he can do. And he's one of the most versatile backs in the country.
Now he shifted out of the pistol. This is a key for Michigan State's defense to keep an eye on him. It's a play-action pass and a completion on first down. And Nijanovic, the fullback, makes a catch, driven out by the true freshman starter at safety tonight, Monte Nicholson.
Watch right here, because of the action, watch how this is going to be a big story tonight throughout this game. And the linebackers and the safeties and how much they respect the running game. See their eyes? Your eyes get affected because of your respect for Amir Abdullah. So even when he doesn't get the ball, he has an impact on this offense.
Initial first down of the game. Crowd trying to make it tough on Armstrong. Play action again. Rolls out near side. Fires and a diving catch at the 43-yard line. Excellent job by Jordan Westerkamp, the crafty, tough-to-cover receiver.
And the guy catches anything and everything. We saw that, I think it was week one, where he made that catch behind his back. This is just an amazing play. Stretching out, first and 10, play action. Look at the hands.
Wet ball?
Wet ball gets his hand down so it doesn't even come close to touching the surface.
He's a slot receiver often who averages about 20 yards a catch. Got just six on that one.
But you know what? Against this defense, first and 10, a throw for a gain of six, that is a
sure.
huge accomplishment.
Abdullah, they fake it to him and dropped in the backfield. Taiwan Jones as the quarterback.
Well, all week, these linebackers with Pat Narduzzi have been running to Amir Abdullah. When you run to Amir Abdullah, the other linebacker's got to account for the quarterback. This time, Twan Jones, 34, does a great job. You can see that Eddie Davis takes Abdullah out. But there, right there, is Twan Jones waiting in the middle just in case he comes off and the quarterback still has the ball. That's assignment football at its finest by Pat Narduzzi's defense.
Some amazing stats for this Spartan defense against the run in the first four games. And it sets up a third and six. Empty backfield. Spartans bring pressure off the edge. Armstrong under immediate pressure is dropped. Ed Davis got him.
Chris, my first look was he offsides? I mean, it looked like either Eddie Davis is offsides or he knew the snap count. I mean, there was no way that Sturup had a chance to make this block. I mean, he's looking, by the time he comes up out of his stance, Ed Davis is by him and in the backfield. And when Michigan State gets you to third down, they pin their ears back and they crank up the pressure. And that is not necessarily Nebraska's greatest strength. They've got to avoid third and medium and third and long all night.
Once again, the Spartans defense comes up with a stop, and here's Sam Foltz. It's a short punt into the wind, and it'll be down to about the 21-yard line. To Robert Flores for an update on this eventful Saturday. Robert? No doubt Spartan fans in the stadium interested in that one.
Yeah, no doubt. Remember, Michigan State has a little bit of a reputation for starting slow, and there's no reason to panic. You know, Connor Cook and a Rose Bowl are going back to even earlier this year against Oregon. They start slow, and then they kind of make adjustments and find a way to try to attack a defense.
Mumphrey in motion, but they hand it back to Langford. He tries the left side, and he's knocked down after a short game.
Really love the way this Nebraska defense right now is attacking. They know that Jeremy Langford is the guy who makes this offense go, despite the jet sweep action, whether it's Mumphrey that's going to go or R.J. Shelton that's kind of trying to affect Nebraska's defense. But they are locked into Jeremy Langford and trying to negate him.
It's a Nebraska defense group that's gotten off to a slow start this year. They'd allowed four opening touchdown drives to opponents to begin games.
Playing with house money, right?
Yes. The turnover on the second play. And now Cook fires over the middle, complete. First down at the 45-yard line. He finds Josiah Price, the tight end, for 21.
Yeah, and I think this time Josh Banderas gets a little bit lost in coverage. Watch the Mike linebacker right in the middle. Just a little bit of a move by Isaiah Price, and that was enough, or by Josiah Price, was enough to impact Banderas and what he was trying to do in coverage. I think he thought he was going to cut underneath, and he ended up continuing downfield vertically.
It's Daniel Davey, Cornhuskers corner, who's down on the field. Osborne era. They've never had a road win over a top 10 team. 0-8 since 1997. So this would be a huge opportunity for Pelini's team to move up. On first down, Cook, play action, fires near sideline. Wide open is Tony Lippitt, who will stroll to the end zone.
Chris, it looked like Lippitt got pushed out of bounds.
The official's hat is off, Kirk, yeah. Which signifies that he stepped out, but if he's forced out, yeah. He can come back in.
Yeah, Jonathan Rose was locked up on him, number 14, and he got physical with him, and getting physical, he actually forced him out of bounds, but Lippitt worked himself back into the field of play, and because of that, he was able to go out and make that play. We just talked about two
yep.
teams feeling each other
out. Well, you said
out.
It. They'll start slow, but yep. then they'll get going.
That's what they do. They kind of see your coverage. They see what you're trying to take away. And I'll tell you, give Dave Warner a lot of credit for the adjustments that they make. They get that football downfield in a hurry.
And the steady Michael Geiger knocks to the point. 55 yards, the seventh touchdown this year for Lippitt.
Yeah, he's down at the bottom, and he's locked up one-on-one. And it's nothing fancy other than you got to win at the line of scrimmage. Lippitt is physical at 6'3", 185 pounds. He gives him a little bit of a move, and that's where he actually got pushed by Rose. When he gave him a little bit of a, kind of a little fake to back to the, coming back to the outside, because Rose was beaten on the play, all he could do was just push him. And when he pushed him out of bounds.
You see Daniel David, the corner, down on the field. In comes Rose. They take a shot right at him with their best receiver. The rest of the team has five touchdown catches. He's got seven.
Seven on the year, and Cook's go-to guy. I mean, Lippitt's gained so much experience over the last couple years. Coming back this year, his senior year, clearly Cook's go-to guy, and he comes up big here for Michigan State.
The senior out of Detroit. They feel he's maybe been targeted too much by Cook. They would like him to spread it around, but the chemistry is so good with Lippitt. They worked so hard over the summer developing that timing. They just seemed to click as a combination, and they went right after the inexperienced corner for the touchdown there. Kevin Cronin to boot it away. If you're a fan of REO Speedwagon, you know that Kevin Cronin was also the name of the former lead singer.
Of course. There's the fingertips. We saw a great catch on the other end from Westerkamp, and this time just outstanding concentration.
If you're Connor Cook, you're glad he came up with that. You don't want to overthrow a wide open receiver for a touchdown there. Interesting story, Lippitt, high school quarterback. Was on the scout team, was corner for a while, shifted back to receiver. D'Antonio likes to get his best athletes on the field wherever they can contribute. And now, of course, he's become the go-to guy for Cook. Abdullah hasn't really gotten going yet. You know, the Cornhusker offense, Kirk, they've been averaging 4.4 yards per carry before any contact. They're used to getting creases and getting to the second level in a hurry. Not happening so far.
Right, right. But, you know, they've also, they've been challenged at times this year, and they don't panic. You know, they're not going to all of a sudden, because they're on the road and you know, the crowd's into the game, they're going to change their game plan. They're still going to do what they came here to do, which is Abdullah and Armstrong making plays.
They throw it near side. This is Kenny Bell, the top receiver for the Cornhuskers, and he's got a first down across the 35 before Trey Wayne's got him.
That's just a good job of recognizing that Kenny Bell didn't have anybody across from him with two receivers to the outside. And if you're not going to put any coverage out there, you see this in these spread offenses all the time. They just come off of their run play and just throw it out real quick. And why not just take an easy first down with an easy throw?
20th catch of the year for the junior from Colorado. And that's Bell in motion now. Armstrong looks for him again, far side. They've got a couple of blockers. Kenny Bell got great speed and shows some strength running with the ball down to the 40 of the Spartans.
Michigan State did not adjust to the motion with Kenny Bell. He's going to motion across, but nobody goes out there with him. Instead, look how they're still locked into the inside. They're still concerned with that boxed area of the running game of Amir Abdullah. Meanwhile, they're letting themselves get outflanked by just Armstrong taking another simple snap and throwing the ball quickly out to the outside to Bell.
Who's a speed guy, but showed some good leg drive at 185 pounds. Dragging some tacklers. And first down. A little option look, and they pitch it to Abdullah. Spartans string it out and hit him for a gain of only one. And Abdullah hasn't gotten going yet. Shalik Calhoun in on the stop.
And give Calhoun all the credit in the world. We just talked about how they're getting outflanked. That time, he does a really good job of getting off of his block and stretching that play out. But Amir Abdullah is 5'9". Chris, what did he come in at? About 175 pounds. He's up to about 203 now.
Yeah, he's from Homewood, Alabama. And the Crimson Tide didn't think he could be a running back. Auburn thought maybe a defensive back.
Yeah. Had to go to Lincoln to be able to have a chance to live out a dream of being a tailback.
And he's joining the pantheon of all-time great running backs at the school. He's got it again. But this is a different sort of run defense that he's faced so far this season. Johnny Rogers, of course, the wing back, won the Heisman Trophy. Mike Rozier in a brilliant three-year career. And Amir Abdullah is tracking down the records of all of these guys in different categories. It's so far, only 8 yards in his first six carries, and the Cornhuskers need eight on this third down. 0 for 2 so far.
Armstrong going to call a timeout.
It's a tough defense to convert on third and eight with an offense that's not really built for that, is it?
No, not at all.
All three possessions, Nebraska's been in Michigan State territory. This is now the ninth play in Spartan territory, and they face a third and eight. Two punts in the first two possessions. Empty backfield. Spartans showing pressure, and they draw the false start.
False start. Offense number 68. 5 yard penalty, still third down.
It's a little embarrassing as the guard Jay Codd just fell back.
Wait, he's holding on. He's holding on for dear life. Just snap the ball. Snap the ball. I'm losing it. I mean, he just starts to tilt and arms.
Those quads are burning.
Yeah. He just boink. I mean, that was tremendous effort.
Quarterback's looking at the sidelines, yeah, not like, helping his guard out there.
Yeah, he was fully committed to that stance.
And now it's third and 13. Abdullah shifts out of the pistol. Armstrong roll, chased, has an opening, doesn't have first down yardage. He was tracked down by Riley Bulla of the famous Michigan State Bulla family. Limping just a bit on the far side. It's fourth down.
Yeah, that's a design to get Armstrong away from all that pressure. Marcus Rush and Calhoun, and it makes a lot of sense. The problem is there's just nobody out there for him to throw the football to. Looked like he came up, like Chris, like you said, limping a little bit after Bulla, Riley Bulla ends up making a play on him.
Another punt as they're just outside the field goal range of Brown into this wind in the first quarter. So once again, Nebraska in Spartan territory, but the possession ends with a punt. Turnovers were the problem for the Cornhuskers a year ago. Five of them, four in the first half, and they were of all varieties in the home game. This was the first time Michigan State ever beat Nebraska. Armstrong really frustrated. It was this particular turnover, this fumble with about a minute to go in the half, that State cashed into a touchdown and a 20-7 lead, end up winning by 13. Armstrong says he's a totally different player now than he was in that game.
Well, he is. I think the offseason conditioning and just being committed to this being his team, because he's now the starting quarterback. Last year, he's kind of feeling his way into that position.
This is Langford with a first down run.
And if you look at Tommy Armstrong after all the turnovers last year, obviously the number one thing he's got to do tonight is take care of the football. It's got to be an outstanding compliment running the football outside of Amir Abdullah running the other way. Some big pass plays. One way to attack Michigan State is through the air.
Langford again, little stutter step, and he hammers across the first down line before Trevor Roach and Corey Cooper brought him down. So the first successful running plays of the night for Michigan State.
We're talking so much tonight about Amir Abdullah, forgetting maybe one of the other great backs in the Big Ten, and that's Jeremy Langford. Of course, I think he had as much to do with their run last year to a Big Ten championship as anybody.
At the big game against Wyoming, he sprained his ankle in the opener against Jacksonville State, but now back to 100%. And first down, Cook rolls, play action. Over the middle, into traffic. He was trying to force the ball into Lippitt. Heather?
Chris, a very frustrated Daniel Davey on the sidelines for Nebraska. Don't forget, he grew up right outside of Detroit, has had this night circled on his calendar since he was rehabbing from ACL a year ago. He is doubtful to return. And this is a player, two interceptions last week against Illinois, so fired up to be playing tonight, just came over, pounded his fist on the bench, very frustrated to be injured early with a lower body injury, Chris.
Heather, as soon as he went out, Jonathan Rose got beat for the touchdown by Lippitt. On second and 10, Cook fires over the head of Lippitt again. They are looking right at number 14.
Well, the other thing here, the adjustment that they've made is they've moved Josh Mitchell now over to that boundary corner where we saw in the touchdown Jonathan Rhodes was. Now you see the senior Josh Mitchell moving over there. And it wouldn't surprise me at this point maybe to see Josh Mitchell follow Lippitt around. Josh Mitchell undersized in comparison to Lippitt, but because he's a veteran and he's experienced, you want to see number 5 matched up on number 14 as much as you can if you're a Nebraska fan.
Mitchell, one of the leaders. He's a captain and the roommate of Amir Abdullah. So 3rd and 10. It's a roll for Cook. And he just fires incomplete again. So Nebraska's defense, once again, it's Randy Gregory pressuring the quarterback and forcing the overthrow.
And again, I think sometimes we all get caught up in sacks. It's not just about sacks. Look at how Gregory does a good job. He actually took a shortcut to get to where the quarterback was going. He's not as a defensive end. He cuts through the line and has an impact on Connor Cook having to throw the ball. Not an accurate throw, but it had a lot to do with Gregory applying that pressure and getting down close to his legs and making him get rid of that football.
Guy that Bo Pelini, John Papuchis, the defensive coordinator, just loves, says Gregory goes hard every single play. Great example. And the punt is shanked off the outside and Sadler's foot and rolls dead at the 37-yard line.
Michigan State's defense came in knowing that they had to do a great job against this Nebraska running game. Zone read, you're going to see a lot of. They're committed to stopping Amir Abdullah, whatever it takes. Here's a guy that's come back off back-to-back 200-yard games. They're going to make Tommy Armstrong and the rest of the Cornhuskers make plays. We'll see if it holds up, but that's Pat Narduzzi's defense. They're willing to give up some plays through the air to Kenny Bell and some others, but they don't want Amir Abdullah to get loose, hit a crease, and take one to the house.
Again, the first possession following the interception by Gregory. They moved it into Michigan State territory on the next two, but never able to get in field goal range. Duel again. Chili Calhoun, junior from New Jersey, all Big Ten player. Needs a big night. He's a big game player, and the coach is focusing on him tonight.
Well, yeah, I think last week was his best game. He's been off to a slow start this year with the high expectations on him. But you know, that zone read, the quarterback's got to, if he commits down to Abdullah, Tommy Armstrong's got to pull that ball out and go around the corner. Remember, be a compliment in the running game to Abdullah's running, because right now they're taking Abdullah out.
Yeah, the first 10 running plays, Kirk, for Nebraska netted 13 yards. Here's a throw near sideline. Bell trying to fight back to the ball, but it's intercepted by Trey Waynes. Got caught up in the wind. An easy pick for the corner.
Yeah, a bad throw by Armstrong, but a great idea by Tim Beck, the offensive coordinator. You have to be able to hit these plays against Michigan State because of the way they leave their corners on islands. But Kenny Bell never had a chance. Great coverage, physical wins, and the best thing is he turns around, he reads the eyes of Kenny Bell, looks into his eyes, sees that he's looking up for the ball, and as all corners are taught, he then turns around, locates the football, and makes the interception. But it starts with being in perfect position against Kenny Bell.
Wayne's the guy's in preseason all Big Ten corner, had 3 picks in the Spartans conference championship year a year ago. So Cook at the 37. Hands it off to Langford. Neither side finding much success running the ball so far.
Not at all. Michigan State, you know, the big play to Lippitt, but right now only 19 yards rushing. Jeremy Langford used to averaging over 5 yards a carry, but I think both of these defense doing a good job in the trenches. Some movement, linebackers attacking downhill.
It's tough to move Vincent Valentin out of there, 325 pounds.
Malik Collins, Valentine, McMullen out of Akron, number 90 on the opposite side of Gregory. It's a good front four.
Quick drop and a throw. Far side complete to Keith Mumphrey, the senior out of Georgia. Josh Mitchell tackles him right at the marker at the 37. And they'll move the chains.
Just a soft corner. The timing, you know, Connor Cook told me this week, he said the thing that really helped us grow and from a where we were winning the Big Ten championship to this year is we spent so much time in the summer when the coaches weren't around I was kind of the offensive coordinator with all these receivers that had experience, and it really allowed us to grow even as an offense at that point in June and July, where he kind of took things over without the coaches out there.
Langford tries to cut it back. Cook also told me, Kirk, that he's used these Michigan State quarterbacks as a resource. So you got guys like Brian Hoyer, of course, Nick Foles, Drew Stanton.
Kirk Cousins.
Pretty good deal. All in the NFL right now.
It's pretty amazing to think the run that Michigan State's on with quarterbacks that have had success not only here in East Lansing, but going up to that next level. And it's very cool to see how willing they are to come back and still be a part of that Michigan State family and willing to help Connor Cook. And I'm sure he'll do that for the next quarterback in line.
Had a half-hour conversation with Cousins after the loss in Eugene. They hand it back on the reverse and trying to muscle as Langford comes up a yard short of the first down. I mean, Michigan State really in the last 5 or 6 years has become one of the quarterback universities, sending guys to the league.
It's almost like Michigan handed the baton to Michigan State and said, not only can you guys start to win a lot more than us, but also you can take over the quarterbacks going to the NFL. Michigan had so many years where they used to send quarterbacks up to the NFL and have success, but all three of those guys doing a great job.
Hoyer, Cousins, and also Nick Foles, who they were all in the same quarterback room for a time at Michigan State. Third and two. It's Langford in the I formation, and he's got it. But he doesn't have the first down as the Cornhuskers penetrate Trevor Roach, the middle linebacker, who steps in as a starter tonight, made the tackle.
Yeah, Trevor Roach was lined up on the edge, but I think Greg McMullen had as much to do with this as anybody. Watch him right here commit down, and Roach is left over because of how he got a great push to the middle. He won his gap, got off the ball fast, and really Langford had nowhere to go but try to bounce it to the outside, and Trevor Roach was sitting there waiting for him. So that time Nebraska dialing up the right defense on third and short.
Huskers are peeking at a potential fake here at the 45-yard line. They need three, but it's Sadler with that Aussie punt. He drops the tip of the football and tries to hit a sand wedge and knock it dead deep. He does that as well as any punter in the country. And it's down at the one.
Hidden yardage, yep. Serious weapon. When it happens, as consistently as it happens here for Michigan State. That's it's one thing for it to happen once in a while, but when you pin an offense that's struggling against a great defense inside the 10-yard line.
Here's the tip of the ball dropped. It helps him get that backspin on it. This is the seventh time he's done that this year, but Sadler in his career has made a specialty out of this. 54 times they've downed a punt inside the 10.
That's why he's on the cover of the program tonight. You asked what? A punter on the cover? That's why.
They put a punter and a guard on the program cover tonight at Michigan State. Huskers got to be very careful. They've generated nothing on the ground so far, and Joel Heath is there to stop Abdullah in that time.
Mark D'Antonio worked for a lot of great coaches. He's with Nick Saban while he was here, when Nick was here as a head coach. Jim Tressel, he's his defensive coordinator at Ohio State. And I think Jim Tressel was outstanding as a coach at managing a game, and special teams was a big part of that. And Mark D'Antonio has learned that part of it. By getting a great punter and a great kicker, you pin an offense inside there like that, you've got a defense like this, boy, that can impact not just field position, but also momentum.
Defenses dominate the first quarter, except for the 55-yard touchdown pass, Cook to Lippitt. That's the difference after the first quarter in East Lansing. Back after this message and a word from your local ABC station. Out wobbly and incomplete. This is a team, Kirk, that rushed for 190 yards in the last game against Illinois. Just 14 in the first quarter here. They do have the wind with them in this quarter, but it's been tough going for Armstrong.
Not only that, and now because of that outstanding punt, now it's third down and long, which is an area it's not a strength of theirs against a defense that is their strength. From your own 1 yard line, they've got to be very careful here. In fact, wouldn't be surprised to see them run the football or get the ball out of the hands quickly for Armstrong.
Armstrong up under center, handing to Abdullah, who spins for a short gain. But number eight hasn't gotten on track yet. Curtis Drummond, the all-Big Ten safety, knocked him down, and Nebraska will punt.
Just to continue that point and how important it is, and we'll see the end result, because you always have to wait. After a punt like that, you wait to see what the offense does when they get pinned inside their own territory like this against the defense. They go three and out. Now you're going to give the ball back to Michigan State, probably in plus territory, and now they've got a chance to be able to put points on the board. And it all stems from that punter putting this Nebraska offense inside their own five.
Let's see if Sam Foles can use the wind. Kings at midfield, tries to circle back and get the corner. Makes a man miss, dances down inside the 30-yard line. So great field position for Michigan State. 19 yards on the return after a 43-yard punt.
We just talked about that. I mean, it's a great opportunity. He decides to return it instead of calling the fair catch. Does a really nice job of making that first guy miss. And once he makes that first guy miss, it was Chris Jones, number 11, right there, who overcommits. Picks up about another 15 yards and a couple great blocks in the process. Now they're all the way down to the Nebraska 31-yard line.
So field position, the excellent putt by Sadler, the coverage setting up this great opportunity. It's Langford. Starts right, breaks a tackle. Langford to the secondary. Down inside the 10 and diving to the end zone. Perfect field possession football and a 31-yard touchdown run.
And a couple poor angles from the Nebraska secondary that opened it up. A great run, great vision by Langford to bounce it back to the backside, and then tremendous effort to get it into the end zone.
So in this duel of productive tailbacks, it's Langford off to the start. He's got a streak of 8 straight conference games with 100 yards gained. That's the longest streak by any back in the FBS. Michigan State up 14-0.
The motion goes this way. Watch how the Nebraska defense adjusts to that motion. And 25, Nate Gary, right there, he slides to the inside for whatever reason. I don't know what he saw, but when he slid to the inside, they busted a gap. And leave it to Jeremy Langford to recognize that, cuts it to the backside, and then shows that heart and effort to get it all the way to the end zone. Spartans up by a couple scores.
Michigan State's offense contained except for 2 big scoring plays. The 55-yard pass Cook to Lippitt and that 31-yard touchdown run by Langford. The 3-play 80-yard drive on the 1-play drive following the punt return. It's Abdullah back deep trying to spark things as a returner. He's been contained as a runner. Abdullah from the 8. Cuts it up, and a nice return to the 30. Another look at the scoring play.
We should go back to this touchdown again. I think the motion here not only caused problems for how they were to fit here, but also a senior corner who just ends up clearing out. He doesn't have his eyes. Josh Mitchell just gets confused here. Great blocking at the point of attack by Michigan State's offensive line, especially the 2 tackles. On the left side, Jack Conklin, who pulled around, and the right side, Cody Keeler. And then just a bad effort by Mitchell to make that tackle.
Kirk, you said that Nebraska will be patient with the running game. It's what they do. It's what they believe in. But now they find themselves down a couple of touchdowns. Armstrong on the keeper. Spun out for a loss. Marcus Rush off the end. Got him.
I think they knew coming in tonight it's going to be tough to run the football against this style of defense. Look how they're holding the edge. I'm telling you, all the talk usually is about Shalik Calhoun, but the senior Marcus Rush out of Cincinnati Moeller, this guy's played as much football as anybody on this defense in the last 4 years. Pat Narduzzi has this defense again this year, playing aggressively, attacking the line of scrimmage, and they're doing it tonight again against Nebraska.
You're right. Rush is an unsung guy. He's got 5.5 tackles for loss. Armstrong on second down, flips it short to Bell, who had some room, stays on his feet, an acrobatic move, just trying to fight back the initial line of scrimmage. Curtis Drummond forced him out. Boy, Kenny Bell is still down over there.
Let's hope he gets up. He's one of their great playmakers. Landed a little bit awkwardly when he came down after the effort by Drummond to make that tackle. They cannot afford to lose him.
It's Bo Pelini looking over him. He looks to be in some pain. Officials trying to clear players off the sidelines. It's third and 12, but the Nebraska offense, are they going to run a play with him laid out close to the sideline like this?
No, not usually. Not while he's laying in that in the white.
Another look at the tackle as Bell stayed on his feet amazingly.
Yeah, he still continues to run. I don't know.
He just landed on the ball, it looked like. And
I thought it might be the way he landed after hurdling Curtis Drummond.
He just came down hard on the football. We hope that's all it is.
How about the pursuit of that defense, though, how they run to the football?
They've been doing it forever.
God.
This is the formula. They've only allowed one first quarter touchdown in the last eight conference games. That was Nebraska a year ago. So they get the lead, and then they just pull away and pummel you.
The bottom line is, if you don't have a balanced attack, if you're one-dimensional against this defense, or if you can't throw the football, it's really, really challenging to be able to move the ball consistently on them. I mean, Amir Abdullah in this system, he's had 200-yard games the last couple weeks against Miami of Florida and Illinois. He barely can get back to the line of scrimmage so far.
So it's the fifth third down play for the Cornhuskers. And once again, they will not convert as Lawrence Thomas drops Armstrong for a loss.
And then they get you to third down, and this time they don't even have to blitz, and they still have great coverage. What they want to do with Armstrong, because he's not a pocket quarterback, is take away his primary read. If you take away his first option and you make him come off of that, he gets uncomfortable. He starts to see too many colors, and that is a coverage sack. They took away the primary receiver and give the assist to the secondary on the sack.
Foltz, punting for a fifth time, gets this one up into the wind. Kings is driven way back, trying to spin free, but dropped down inside the 20-yard line. Lane Hovey on the coverage, a 54-yard punt. Negative three on the return. Michigan State back on offense, up by a couple of scores.
Refreshingly hard.
Folks in East Lansing in a great move. The Spartans are up by a couple touchdowns. Wisconsin, considered the preseason favorite over in the West, lost to Northwestern. They got a kick out of that here. Michigan's losing at halftime to Rutgers. All's good at the moment.
At the moment.
The Spartan Nation.
Yeah.
It can change fast,
sure
but at
can.
The moment. They fake it to Langford. Cook rolls out a first down throw. Looks over the middle. Fires. Catch made. And that's Aaron Burbridge. Across the 40-yard line. So a first down throw, and now the game plan loosening up a bit with the lead.
Yeah, they like to move him around, move the launch point. He wanted to actually go to the right. The receiver was bracketed, so he comes all the way back from his right, all the way back to his left, which is his third option, and puts it right in the position for Burbridge to come back to the football for a first down. That's the experience right there of Connor Cook.
Play caller Dave Warner told us he had regrets about his play calling at Oregon. Had the lead, he felt he wasn't quite aggressive enough, and given that position, he would not make the same mistake. The ball comes loose, though. Langford lost the handle, and the Cornhuskers have it. Trevor Roach, the bottom of the pile, and a turnover. So suddenly, fortunes perhaps shifting here.
Yeah, it looked like Byerson Cockrell got in there as well. 28. This is what Nebraska needed, not just to be able to slow them down, but to get the short field to work with. Roach gives the effort, but I think it's 28 that ends up securing the football there. Cockrell, kind of the guy that we talked about in the open, a guy that's got to make plays, but a nice job of getting penetration by Greg McMullen to knock the ball loose from Jeremy Langford, and now Nebraska's got great field position here to see what they can do with it.
uncharacteristic of Langford. And the first lost fumble for the Spartans this season. So Cornhuskers at the 41. Once again, they're in Michigan State territory. This is the second time they've begun a drive after a turnover in plus territory. A first down throw for Armstrong. Fits it into a gap, but Tariq Allen makes a catch and picks up nine.
You know, I think we're all watching the screen and we're thinking, okay, nobody's covering the inside receiver. You've got to be able to take advantage of this guy right here. Nobody's across from him, so you just perfectly thrown football. A great route where Allen just kind of sat in the soft spot. And the more success you have of doing that, it'll open up the running game for Amir Abdullah.
Second and short.
Maybe.
Abdullah stopped immediately.
Maybe. It'll open it up. But they really do. They have to be willing to throw some on first and 10. Let Michigan State know that it's there. Otherwise, it's very tough to move the ball and running it.
One of the true freshmen playing tonight for the Spartans defense, Malik McDowell, nose tackle on that stop. So it's third and one. Abdullah shifts out of the pistol. Spartans defense just running downhill, but Abdullah just able to fight for a first down as a flag comes out after the play. Wiley Buddha cut him down. Hard earned yardage. Will the first down stand? The Spartans say it's on Nebraska. It's John O'Neill.
I think it was a late hit.
After the play was over, personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Offense number 74. The result of the play was a first down. After the enforcement of the penalty, it'll be first and 10.
That's the senior guard, Mike Moody, so they get the first down, but back at a 15, that will not improve Pelini's mood.
No, the play's over. And he comes from the right of the screen, 74, play's over. It wasn't necessarily that it was a big hit. It was probably an effort by him, but the whistle had blown for a couple seconds. The play was dead. And then he just decides to dive into the pile there right in front of the officials. And they had great field position, and now it pushes them back. It was after the play, so it's first and 10.
But at the 45 instead of the 30. Here's a first down show. This is Allen. And the Spartans fight through the blocks and hammer him hard to the 45. No gain. It was Curtis Drummond, the all-Big Ten safety.
Well, they have great safeties and a great tradition of having good safeties. Drummond is the senior. He's out of the Ohio area as well. But not only does he do a good job of getting off of the block and making a play, but watch the true freshman, Monte Nicholson, also cleaning it up. He's a true freshman at 6'2", 210 pounds. They say he's a future superstar as well.
Guy out of the Pittsburgh area. Armstrong throws downfield. Well covered and incomplete. Tried to get the ball to Abdullah, but Ed Davis is running right with the running back.
Like Riley Bulla as well in coverage, trying to get downfield to try to have an impact on that play. I like the call personally. The running the football is just very, very tough to do. And even though that was second and 10, the idea of trying to get one-on-one coverage with a linebacker against Amir Abdullah who can catch the football like a receiver, good call, but good coverage that time by Bulla.
Third and 10. Armstrong rolls out. Nobody open. And he fires low and incomplete. So once again, Nebraska starts in plus territory. Backed up 15 by the personal foul.
Look at these routes and you tell me who to throw the football to. You said there's nobody open. What do you do if you're Tommy Armstrong? There's nowhere to go with the football. I mean, on third down, he doesn't want to sit in the pocket. He's got to roll out. But like you said, they get a personal foul. It erases the turnover, the opportunity, and plus territory. Give Michigan State's defense some credit, but also a bonehead mistake.
You can see that Armstrong's getting frustrated as the punt is muffed, and the Cornhuskers fall on the ball at the 25. Another big mistake by Michigan State. The second fumble tonight, that time King never got control of it. And Nebraska, for a third time, is set up in plus territory after a turnover.
You know that wind that's out there that's having a little bit of an impact on the passing game? I think it's also having a big impact here on special teams. King's never did a good job. He just kind of was trailing with the ball, letting just drifting.
Nebraska never committed to catch it, did he?
No, it goes
off of his fingertips. Yeah, right there, you can see the ball just change direction.
You know,
let it go if you're
like,
not going to go after
it's like
it.
Judging a fly ball, you've got to get under it, and he was just kind of drifting with the ball as opposed to getting completely underneath it. And here they are again. Great opportunity. Let's see what they try to do on first and 10.
A third first half turnover. So far, the Cornhuskers have not been able to get a thing out of it. Abdullah in the pistol. Just nothing doing in the middle. They cannot create a crease at all. Darian Harris joining Lawrence Thomas.
In defense of the line or the offensive lineman, watch the linebackers as soon as the ball is snapped. Watch their mentality and how much they respect any fear of play action, any fear of anything other than Abdullah. They are locked in and running downhill.
You love the downhill attacking linemen. Defensive.
Oh, it's because by the time the linemen come out of their stance, they're getting ear hole.
They fake it. Armstrong fires in the flat. This is Abdullah trying to make a man miss. Stutter step. Now you see the skills of the running back. First and goal for Nebraska.
Well, it's great to see Amir Abdullah for the first time tonight get out in space and have a chance to be able to do something. They give him a little bit of a different look. Kind of that diamond formation with three backs in the backfield right there in space. Ed Davis had no chance of being able to stop Amir Abdullah. This is what they want to do, be able to get him in a position to be able to make plays. That time he does show you the quickness and acceleration.
His sixth catch of the year. If you can't run it, you got to find other ways to get him touches, right? Armstrong keeps it, makes a man miss, dives forward for about four.
That's great. I mean, it looked like he was going to be tackled by Calhoun for about a loss of three. Made him miss, made a couple others miss, and picked up a few positive yards.
Nebraska running its 20th play in plus territory tonight. In the Wildcat, this is Abdullah, straight ahead. Oh, had a block, but the Spartans knocked the ball loose and pick it up. Shalik Calhoun is running the other way. And Michigan State once again finds a way to kill a drive.
Well, Ed Davis comes in to clean up this play. I thought he might be down, but Chris, looking at it closely, Ed Davis right here knocks the ball loose with his hand. His knee is not down. And a great reaction by the Spartans defense to see that football.
Ed Davis just punches the ball free before the elbow hits the ground right there. And Shalik Calhoun at 256 pounds got up and ran with it. They tracked him down at the 45, but once again, Nebraska comes up empty.
Well, they're going to take a peek at it. His right hand touches, but his elbow never touched. Yeah. His knee never touched. The ball is out. Ed Davis aggressively going in there. Darian. That's Ed Davis knocking that ball loose. And the thing that, he's definitely still up. Do you look at this and you say, boy, Nebraska misses out on another opportunity? Or it's a little bit of, how about Michigan State's defense getting backed up into their own end zone and making plays at the same time? I think it's a combination of the two.
That's just a terrific, well-aimed punch by Davis. As Nebraska went to the Wildcat look down there, they're searching for answers to move the ball at all. And Michigan State, the defense bailed out the offense three times after turnovers. Review,
the ruling on the field of fumble recovered by Michigan State is confirmed. First down.
A very frustrating night for a running back that had, with a possible exception of Todd Gurley, as good a September as anybody. 167 yards per game coming in. He's carried it already 13 times, but only for 21 yards, and now a fumble.
Couple turnovers for this Nebraska offense. Boy, they definitely had some chances. Now let's see how their defense holds up against Connor Cook, who's just starting to warm up.
And a first down throw for Cook. Caught! Breaking free is Keith Mumbry. You see how accurate Cook is. There wasn't a lot of space for that throw, was there?
No, not at all. But I love the call here on first and 10. And I love that he didn't give up on that play. That's pretty physical coverage that time. But he's able to not eventually pulled away, but the coverage is tight. It's just a great throw by Connor Cook.
Josh Kalu was right there on Mumbry. The quarterback
does have confidence in his arm, and for good reason. Young beginning to come down a little heavier now. Here comes a trick play on the reverse. There's some room for R.J. Shelton, but the Cornhuskers string it out well. They stop him short of a first down. So then Dave Warner up a couple of touchdowns. Started opening up the playbook here.
These are some of the wrinkles in the way this offense has really evolved over the last couple of years.
This is Nick Hill, a little 5'8 senior tailback. He's given Langford a breather, and he carries for a first down inside the 20-yard line. Boy, all these missed opportunities, Kirk, that Nebraska has had. They have three takeaways. If Michigan State punches it in here, goes up 21-0. Halftime approaching, the rain falling. Things looking not great for the red and white. It's Hill in the I formation behind the fullback Pendleton. And they give it to him. Good block in the corner. And he shows good quickness. Knocked out at the 13 by Jerry.
Langford does most of the damage for this offense, but I think Nick Hill is a nice compliment. Delton Williams will also come in, the sophomore, more of a pounder at 230 pounds. But this offense really has everything you're looking for. I mean, you've got an experienced quarterback. You've got backs led by Jeremy Langford, a big offensive line, which they always have here, and five or six receivers that all can run every single route that you have. And this, and a team that has experience and confidence off of the year of winning a Big Ten championship.
Another second down carry for Hill, who darts down inside the 10. He's a guy who's a graduate. He could have transferred and played another year at another program instead of backing up Langford, but the coaches appreciate that he's stuck around.
I think great teams have tandems. They've got to have more than one guy typically to have an outstanding offense, because you know, you get running backs and offenses like this where you still like to run the football a lot. Langford needs to, you know, take a series or two off, and to be able to have Hill, who's completely different style of runner, he's more of a kind of side to side quicker back, whereas Langford's kind of a slasher. So they bring something a little bit different for the defense to have to deal with.
This formation on third and one. But up inside, and the Cornhuskers rise up at the 10-yard line, and Malik Collins stopped him short. So fourth down and short.
Collins is a heck of an athlete at 300 pounds. He and Vincent Valentine anchor that inside of that front four.
Sophomore from Kansas City, off to a strong start. So it's a field goal attempt for Michael Geiger in his career, 19 of 21. Just a sophomore. So after the Calhoun fumble recovery and return to the 45, the Spartans stretch the lead to 17. So the Spartans don't get seven there. That was an important stand, Kirk, for the Nebraska defense to not fall 21 points down in the rain on the road with an offense that's struggling against a great defense.
Yeah, the third down play by Collins really saved Nebraska to be able to keep him in this game and give them some hope. But this, until this offense starts to make plays, it's going to be tough.
Abdullah fumbles it, comes up with it now at the 11-yard line, and now has a little bit of a crease. And accelerates across the 30-yard line. So 4:25 before halftime for the Cornhuskers to cut in to this lead.
Now it's time for the Aflac trivia question. As you referenced earlier, three Michigan State quarterbacks starting tomorrow in the NFL. Prior to this season, which was the last Big Ten school to have three starting quarterbacks in a single NFL week?
Really? You'd say maybe Michigan right away.
It Bear wouldn't ask it if it were Michigan, because that would be too easy. That's why I'm feeling Illinois or Purdue. Let me
he actually given me a chance this week. Prepare.
On first down, Armstrong fires, but misfires, trying to get it to Westerkamp. Nothing working for the quarterback so far.
No, no. And I think that Tim Beck, the offensive coordinator, knows that they're going to have to be able to have success throwing the ball. Michigan State dares you. They're over on the other side of the field looking at you saying, we dare you. Our corners are locked up man-to-man right in the face of your receivers. Our safeties are isolated. We dare you to throw the ball. And if you don't, we're going to stop your running game.
Armstrong fires far side again into tight coverage. And now the flag comes in. They're going to get Waynes, who had the pick earlier, an interference against Tariq Allen.
Well, they're physical. I mean, they challenge you that time. That was a close call.
Pass interference, defense number 15. Ball will be placed at the spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
The goal for Narduzzi's defense, he said, the corners have to disrupt the timing of the route at the line.
They do that every week.
a little too disruptive there.
I think with his right arm towards the end of the play came through for the interference. But I just love to see Tim Beck saying, hey, Tommy, we're gonna have to make some plays through the air. That can soften this defense up and give you a chance to run the football. But you're going to have to throw to run.
That's Allen in motion. Now he's got it in the flat. But the pass kind of overled him, and he stumbled forward. No gain.
There are a lot of teams that face this Michigan State defense where they lock their corners one-on-one. There isn't anybody behind them. They're on an island. And then they'll put their safeties in what they call quarters coverage, but they're really in man-to-man situations. And they try to pick on the safeties in coverage and the slot against the inside receivers.
Abdullah out of the backfield. And again, Armstrong had him wide open, overthrew him. Ed Davis pressured him, but that's on the quarterback.
Well, he hurried his throw. He's still a young quarterback who's getting more and more comfortable when they drop him back to sit in the pocket. He realizes way better than me and you the pressure that's coming at him. Ed Davis was coming. I mean, it was 3-2-1, get rid of it. And I think his eyes, instead of being downfield to his receiver, he's looking at number 43 coming right at him. And that's affecting his accuracy and his rhythm.
They need 10 on third down. Spartans showing pressure up the middle again. Play clock at 2, got to hurry. Didn't get it off. Did not get the play off. The Spartans showed pressure right up the middle, and that caused some hesitation.
Right to the snap. Delayed game offense. 5-yard penalty, still third down.
Chris, the third down, they show blitz. And then as the ball get, watch that, just play it all the way through. Watch the ball snap. Now watch, defensive tackle, the nose guard drops. It's a zone pressure. So your offensive line's on the road. You're trying to figure out there's seven guys at the line. Who's going to come? Who's going to drop? And at the snap of the ball, the nose guard, Lawrence Thomas, drops along with two other linebackers.
Look at the average distance to go on third down play, almost 9 yards. No wonder they're 1 of 7. Armstrong again, pressured and knocked down. Shalik Calhoun, the big game player, shining on the big stage tonight. Nebraska will punt again.
And Michigan State fans love to see this. This is just raw speed coming off of the edge. That's the Shalik Calhoun that Michigan State fans have fallen in love with over the course of the last couple years. He has shown glimpses of that this year, but you're starting to see him last week and now this week play the way you really come to expect to see him play. That was just quickness and tremendous athletic ability off that edge against Sturrup.
I talked to Shalik this week. He was fired up, a fast-talking, energized guy. Colts boots it away, and with the win, it's a pretty good one. And the coverage is good as they drop him at the 23-yard line. Mr. Felica, time for your Affleck trivia question answer.
I'm going to say Wisconsin.
Well, you are wrong. It's time to answer the question. You were right, though. I did try to get you to say Michigan, but the answer is Purdue. Back in 2011 is the answer to tonight's Affleck trivia question. Purdue. You would get Kyle Orton, Drew Brees, and the other?
Curtis Painter,
absolutely. With the
what
Colts.
If I threw a question back at you, Mr. Felica?
Any time.
All right, how about right now?
Talk to me.
Mark D'Antonio has turned around the head-to-head rivalry against Michigan. He's 5-2. Not Saban. Who is the last Michigan State head coach to finish with a winning record against Michigan?
Duffy Daugherty.
Cook rolls out. Fires incomplete. Is it caught? They rule it? No, incomplete. You are wrong, Mr. Felicki. You answered quickly, but incorrectly.
I'm sorry.
Got to go back before Duffy Doherty. Okay.
See, I knew it wouldn't
before
be George Perlis.
Duffy Doherty.
Okay. Before Duffy Doherty. Duffy was 3-4.
Close.
Perlis 4-8. Saban 2-3 against the Wolverines. It wasn't John L. He didn't beat him at all in four tries, but Biggie Munn did.
Oh.
Biggie Munn won 4-7.
Why would you even come up with a question like that?
Because I knew Felicki was going to trick us again, and I wanted a small measure of revenge.
Right.
And because it plays into this.
I love it.
Because Antonio, the biggest thing he did before winning the conference in the Rose Bowl was turn things around against Michigan, right? Here's Langford trying to bounce it, but Gregory drags him down, wouldn't let him get the corner.
Well, that's just a great play. This shows you the growth of Randy Gregory. Used to be, you know, last year as a junior college player, his first year, just more of a pass rush, kind of a specialist coming off the edge. Now he takes on the block first, and then he also chases the play down. Look at that. He's going up against an offensive tackle, takes him on, sheds him, and then has the speed to chase down Jeremy Langford from behind and bring him down. That's a big-time play by Gregory.
Earlier we had the pick on the carom that the Cornhuskers couldn't cash in. There's a third down and 9 for Michigan State. Perhaps Nebraska will get the ball back. Pelini wants to get a timeout.
Starting
a little heavier here.
It is. I think part of the reason that Bo Pelini called that timeout, they move Randy Gregory around. He's not just a defensive end on third down. They try to make the offensive line guess where he might be. And it was one of those things where they wanted to make sure they got him in the right spot. Right now he's lined up right there. And you'll see him move.
Cornhuskers bring 4 rushers. Cook has good protection, fires far side into traffic, and the first down catch made by Lippitt against 2 defenders in Nebraska territory.
That's bracket coverage, meaning 5. Mitchell has him to the outside, and the safety, Gary, has him to the inside. That is great accuracy. And that time, I don't think Josh Mitchell did a very good job of turning to find the football. And that's where you trust your receiver to put it up there on third down against double
trust coverage. Is the word, right, between those two. But their first down throw on the deflection, it's incomplete. You realize when he targets Tony Lippitt so far this year, Cook is completing 79% of his passes. That's exceptional.
That's why on third down, even though he's double covered, you're still going to throw the football to him. You trust him to be able to go up and make a play.
All opponents, when they look at Cook on tape, they see a quarterback that puts the ball in the tight spaces, trusts his arm, can make all the throws. Definitely next level ability.
In the NFL, you watch the games and the quarterbacks, they trust their receivers. Their receivers a lot of times don't look like they're open, but they put the ball in a place where their receiver can make a play on the ball.
The second down throw, it's a screen. The throw incomplete. That, by the way, catch by Lippitt was the first third down conversion for the Spartans tonight. You combine that with the fact that they have 3 turnovers, yet still lead 17-0.
And with a minute 38 to go, Michigan State thinking obviously about more points. They have all 3 of their timeouts. So another third down or pass protection against Gregory. Last time they held up very, very well when he put it up in the coverage to Lippitt. Lippitt now moves around. Now he's in the slot down to the bottom, inside receiver.
In motion, Nick Hill back into the backfield. He immediately looked that direction, and the pass is complete. Not getting first down yardage, but McGarrett King with his 5th catch of the season. Josh Mitchell stopped him. It's 4th and short. And the Spartans are going. They need a yard outside of field goal range for Michael Geiger into this wind. And it looks like they'll take their time here. No hurry on the clock with all 3 timeouts.
Antonio just standing right next to an official.
Doesn't matter how heavy the rain is, he's not putting on a raincoat. The hoodie is the look, right? In all weather.
It's the Belichick look, right?
Never lost a game after taking a 17-point lead. Not with the defenses he's had over the years. So 52 seconds before halftime. 4th and 1. Chance for the Spartans to sort this out. And Nebraska comes in here, Kirk, filled with belief. And they beat Michigan State a couple years ago. They had a 300-yard rushing game. They ran it pretty well, even in the home loss last year. But absolutely nothing doing for Abdullah in the ground game tonight.
No, and I think it has everything to do with Pat Narduzzi's determined to overcommit to the line of scrimmage, take his chances in coverage on the outside. And I think his logic is, we're going to get to you if you throw the ball before you make us pay for it in man-to-man coverage. By the way, it's not just for Nebraska this week. This is what they do. They did it last week. They'll do it next week. They'll do it the rest of the year. And it works. They're probably, of all the defenses you watch in the country, they're as fun to watch because they have an offensive mentality on defense. And if you can't throw the ball and make them pay for it, it's going to be a long night.
And if you're Nebraska, you have to be opportunistic. When you're an underdog team on the road against a defense like this, second play of the game, they get a pick by Gregory. They're set up at the 30-yard line, come up empty, and that's set the tone for the entire half so far. So the Spartans rushing back in there on fourth and one after the timeout. And now some confusion. They tried to sneak out there at the last second, didn't leave themselves enough time, and have to spend another timeout. Frustration for D'Antonio. Yeah, I know that Narduzzi's defense is aggressive, and they're used to doing this, but Nebraska also feels on the other side that they can get this guy loose against any defensive scheme. It just hasn't happened.
No, and I think that if you're going to compare last year that they were able to get him on track, or 2 years ago, from year to year things change, and it's wet, it's windy, it's harder to throw the football. There are a lot of things that kind of come into play. And I think this Michigan State defense, even though they got off to a slow start in the way they played against Oregon, they're getting better every single week and starting to become very similar to some of the defenses we've seen these last couple years.
Abdullah, such an impressive guy. The ninth of nine children, all of them have gone to college. But it's been a frustrating night. And after another timeout, it's fourth and one. They hand it to Langford. And he muscles for a first and almost broke free. Knocked down there, and now with 47 seconds to go, they'll stop the clock, and a flag came in after the play. A flag came in after the play, and Connor Cruz, the offensive lineman, is being pushed back by teammates.
I think Jack Allen looked like the center for Michigan State.
After the play was over, dead ball, unsportsmanlike. Offense number 66, yeah. 15 yards, first down.
It's the center who they got back after missing the Wyoming game. Again, an offensive lineman after the play.
Going after Malik Collins, number 7. Being aggressive. Again, we saw one go the other way, yep, against Nebraska. He's just being aggressive. It's a dead ball foul. I'd personally love to see an aggressive mindset from offensive linemen. But, anytime after the whistle.
He wasn't buying it. You can tell he didn't like it. Just like Nebraska, Kirk, had moved the ball from the 30 to the 45. So they got a long way to go to get in field goal range now with 41 seconds to go. Still the one timeout. Cook fires incomplete. It is at the feet of Price.
I think that's when you saw Mark D'Antonio's face when they tried to hurry onto the field and try to snap it, and they ran out of time, had to use a timeout. That's why he was frustrated as much as anything. You're down to two timeouts. Still, you have some time. If you pick up the first down with two timeouts, now all of a sudden you're down to one timeout, and instead of maybe thinking about taking a few shots and trying to get into the end zone, now chances are you're looking at more than likely a field goal opportunity because of losing that timeout.
Geiger's career long is 49, but these are not perfect kicking conditions looking into the wind in this quarter. Cook fires far side, and a diving attempt incomplete. Burbridge could not come up with it, and it's third down with 30 seconds left.
Trying to squeeze his throw in between a corner and a safety, and he actually ends up getting in there. When he threw it, it looked like this ball doesn't have much of a chance at all. But a pretty good effort there by both the quarterback and the receiver, Burbridge.
Spartans again, just 1 of 8 on third down tonight. The offense has been all about two big plays. Other than that, not very efficient at all. Cook, quick drop, throws again far side. Similar play. Coming down with the ball is Burbridge, but he's out of bounds. Josh Kalu, the true freshman, is on the coverage, and it's fourth down. Another look.
Yeah, I think his left foot is close to coming back down in bounds, but it may be the heel touched the line. They'll probably take another peek
at that.
Very
close, you're right.
Yeah.
They just showed it on the replay screen here. The crowd believes it's a catch. Is there enough to turn it over? Can you see green between the heel and the line?
Yeah, they're going to have to take another look at this. The heel was close. Now, here's this is the best look you'll probably see.
Heel is in the air, it looks like, right there. When he comes down, it's right on the edge of the line. Will they see enough indisputable video evidence to overturn it? Bill Lemagne, our official in the booth. What's your opinion on that, Bill?
Well, we saw the foot come down, and the whole foot has to be in bounds
right
there. The heel hit the line. This should be an incomplete pass.
You're convinced it hit the line. Okay.
Bill, can I ask you a question? Because watching all these games today, if a receiver goes up into the air like that, comes back down, and the first thing to touch is his toe, and then the heel comes down and it touches the line, but the toe already established that he's in bounds, but then it comes back down and the whole foot then eventually touches the line, the heel touches. Is that a completion?
I hear what you're saying on that, Chris, but you can take a still shot. I'm sorry, Chris, yeah, and Kurt. You can take a still shot and make it look really solid he's in. That's a foot that came down. He's got to show a definite act that he was toe-tapping.
Okay.
After further review, the ruling on the field of an incomplete pass stands. Fourth down.
That's why you're the pro.
I think it should have been confirmed.
Yeah, they said stands, not confirmed, right? The different burden confirmed of proof there.
There you go.
All right, but it is a fourth down. 15 yards farther away because of that personal foul, that ball.
Again, the last two plays, it looked like they didn't have much of a chance. He almost hit Burbridge on the third down play, and then that one, boy, just a tremendous effort. Almost ended up making it for the field goal.
Sadler the punt. There is no returner back there. And that's what he does. Absolutely amazing at that skill. It rolls dead at the two. Second time tonight Sadler's done that, an umpteenth time in his career.
It's just, it's as valuable as this defense. I mean, and the way Connor Cook plays. It's something you never can overlook and never take for granted. It happens so often when you watch him do this.
Different technique that time. He did not drop the
right
nose down the Aussie style. He just got the lefty side spin. He's a colorful dude. He's kind of like the team joker. He's got his own Twitter feed. He's run the ball three times on fakes, and he keeps his stats on there.
He had the Aussie, right?
Yeah.
And that was the knuckleball.
Yeah.
So it's like
the repertoire.
Exactly.
That's why he's on the cover of the program tonight, right?
I'm not just going to give you one look. I'm going to give you a couple different looks.
He's going to tweet about that all week.
He should.
So Nebraska with 14 seconds, the kneel down. What a frustrating first half for the Cornhuskers. 86 total yards, 85 actually, after the kneel down. Three takeaways. They get nothing out of it. And they trail by 17. Down to Heather.
Chris, thanks so much. Coach, what's been your biggest frustration?
Well, we got beat up front in the first half. Not on the offensive side of football. We can't run the football, and obviously that's hurt us. So we had opportunities in that first half. We had field position. We had chances to put points on the board, and we didn't take advantage of those opportunities.
You talk about those missed opportunities. How do you better capitalize in the second half?
We need to play better. We'll get some things figured out.
Oh, thanks for the time.
Total of 5 turnovers in the first half. Michigan State, 2 big scoring plays, lead at 17-0. The end of the first half in East Lansing. Stay tuned after these messages for the halftime report. For a net of 13 yards, when you factor in 3 sacks, Abdullah's running for just 21.
It's an offense coming into this game that was averaged 7.5 yards a play, almost 7 yards a carry, and they knew coming in it was going to be tough. You're on the road, it's slippery, it's wet. The Michigan State defense is taking away the running game, and I think in this second half they're going to still have to try to do the same thing. Hope that Tommy Armstrong on 1st and 10 is able to make some plays throwing the football and then get back to Abdullah in that running game. But man, everything they tried just coming up a little bit short.
Nebraska working into the wind here in the third quarter, and the long kickoff by Cronin is a touchback.
Yeah, there just hasn't been anywhere for him to get out and do what he does best, which is make people miss. Remember when Heather Cox opened up the broadcast interviewing Mark D'Antonio, and how do you stop Amir Abdullah? Well, we got to leverage the football. That means squeeze him from the outside in, take away any space. This is a play late in the first half where they were actually moving deep into Michigan State territory. Fumbles the football by a great play by Ed Davis. So just the only time we've ever seen him out in space is when they threw the ball out of the backfield and gave him a chance to make some people miss.
They've targeted him three times as a receiver. He has the one catch. Now they flip it far side, but knocked down immediately is DeMornay Pearson out. Curtis Drummond's had a big ball game.
As much as the Michigan State defense lives on the edge with their mentality and how aggressive they are very, very disciplined and buttoned up with reading their keys and assignments and making quick decisions as a defense.
Huskers trying to play with some tempo, but on second and 15, just nothing there. Joel Heath with, again, Ed Davis, the money linebacker, as they call him, filling.
And tempo is a good thought from Tim Beck and Bo Pelini. You're going in at halftime, what are you going to do? You got to somehow get this defense on its heels. And if you're not going to throw the football to be able to do it, maybe some tempo could try to slow down some of their aggression and try to get them to get back on their heels. But right now, that's not happening either.
And third and 16, fired across the middle, trying to work free was Westerkamp, but it's incomplete, and a quick three and out for Nebraska to begin this third quarter. Both offenses have struggled mightily on third down. Nebraska now 1 of 9. Spartans are just 1 of 7.
If you don't have success on first and second down, and you get into those third and long situations against any defense, it's hard, but especially against this group. It's just swimming upstream.
Eighth punt already for Nebraska. Garrett Kings give the Spartans some good field position. Boot goes up into the wind and it's pretty short. And it'll bounce out of bounds. A flag is down as the Huskers down it at the 45. Flag was on the near side. Could end up spoiling good field position.
During the kick, holding number 7 on the receiving team, 10 yards from the end of the kick, first down.
That's Demetrius Cox. Heather, what do you have?
Mark D'Antonio's message in the locker room at halftime: play like it's 0-0. Take it away from them. He told his team, we've been in this situation before. He was frustrated at how careless they were with the football, but then applauded his defensive effort. We talked some more about how they slowed down Amir Abdullah, just 21 yards. And Kirk, like you talked about, he emphasized one more time, great pursuit, proper structure, and playing our responsibilities. Just true assignment football to contain that run game.
Heather, this is one of those films, if it continues in the second half, as a defensive head coach, you just smile. You just smile, and you're proud of Pat Narduzzi and this defense, but they still have another half to go.
This is Drummond. Gets the corner. He got right around Josh Kalu, who took an inside angle. It's a first down game. Here's our Pacific Life game summary. Look at some of the key stats in the first half. Turnovers again. You don't figure to lose the ball three times in a half if you're Michigan State, but turned into nothing by Nebraska, who spent most of the half in Michigan State territory.
Yeah, and Connor Cook only had 7 completions, but he hit a few big ones. I mean, he'd be the first one to tell you, even though they have a nice lead, he in the passing game can work a lot more efficiently than having 7 completions in a half.
Yeah, 7 for 19. On first down, Drummond doesn't get much. Of course, what D'Antonio was referencing was the comeback by Oregon when the Spartans had the lead. Mariota made a play, turned it around, and it was a 28-zip run to end the game. But tonight, they're at home, and they're not facing Mariota.
No, they're not in that atmosphere or facing that quarterback. But they did sit. People forget they had a 9-point lead in the third quarter. And there was a play by Mariota on a big third down that changed the complexion, and not just that drive, but the end of the game, because I think it sparked Oregon late in that football game. But they did learn from it. They said they want to keep their foot on the accelerator.
There's a delayed handoff. Langford is tracked down and dropped for a big loss. Trevor Roach got him back at the 45. They lose six. Here's the flashback. What you mentioned in September 6th, a great start for Connor Cook. Lippitt was getting free, and this play.
That's it.
Mariota escapes, and it flips the ball out.
Yeah, you had both linebackers there to be able to make a play. That was third and long, and they had all the momentum in the world, even though they were in Austin. And by him escaping and flipping that out, leads to a touchdown. Crowd got back into the game, then it led to the 28 unanswered that you talked about.
If they had held the lead, Michigan State would be sitting right there in the top three and four with the upsets today. It would be in tremendous position. Cook on third and 14. Fires over the middle. It's low. Incomplete. Would have been a first down catch. Humphrey couldn't come up with it.
You know, that's the other thing that some of these teams face when they play in a game like this. Michigan State's not only playing against Nebraska, with all these teams up in the front at the top of the polls losing today, they realize even with a loss, there's an opportunity for them to get back in that discussion. And so they're trying to, with no mistake, all these coaches are trying to impress anybody and everybody, especially those 13 people on a committee.
Look who's back, Kirk. Colorful Mike Sadler. When he downed that previous punt there inside the five, he made the little motion like he was petting the cat. And that's kind of an inside reference. He promised his Twitter followers he would do that. It's a reference to Bo Pelini and the cat that Bo brought out at spring. He's clever, this punter. Reference to this, the fake Bo Pelini account, Faux Pelini, that opposed the Nebraska coach with a cat for his 131,000 followers. And then Bo
had some fun with it.
Did.
The spring game, he came out with his cat.
Talk to him. He's amused by it somewhat. The flag comes in on the short first down carry. That's sort of in the holding zone, and the problems continue. This Nebraska offensive line, Pelini, he was very simple with his analysis. We're getting beat up front at Michigan State. And now they're trying to hold him, to keep him from flying downhill.
Well, you get beat up front because you have a front that, not when you say the front, just defensive line and linebackers.
Holding, offense number 71, half the distance from the previous spot, repeat first down.
They are just going after what they have to do with Amir Abdullah. You know, and anybody that wants to say, well, why don't they throw it? Why don't they try to do some other things? They're building a wall. That's what they call it. When they blitz their linebackers on almost every run play, they call that building a wall and making you have to either go around them or over top of them, again, with that throwing game.
Another handoff and absolutely nothing. You cannot move Joel Heath, the junior from Cincinnati, out of there. The stats, I mean, three sacks, a total of 12 rushing yards. You mentioned the average, but what, 7.5 a play coming in Nebraska?
Yeah. 2 yards, we're allowing 2 yards a play.
Second and 18. Play action, Armstrong fires far side and just underthrows Allen again. Shalik Calhoun was in his face.
And when you get pressure, it affects any quarterback, but especially a quarterback that's not having a lot of success, so you can't step into your throw. Calhoun at the top, 89, he comes off of it and does enough to be able to get to him. Remember, Calhoun is 6'5", but when a quarterback is falling back on about a 15-yard outcut, you're just not going to be able to make that throw. You need to step into the throw. Here they are again, third and long.
They rush only four. Armstrong still pressured. Ball comes out. They rule it incomplete now. Incomplete. Bullock picked it up, but that time it was the other end, not Calhoun, but Marcus Rush.
Say, a guy who's having a rough day is Zach Stirrup, and it's just the speed. Calhoun's gone around him, and now it's Marcus Rush, the senior, to the left, just goes around him. It's the same move that Calhoun has used, different way of doing it because he uses some power as well, but it's the quickness to get around the corner to, again, get to that quarterback. They rush four that time, no blitz, drop seven, and still get home and affect the quarterback.
Arm was just coming forward.
Arm's coming forward, so it's an incompletion.
Can you stop and review this?
His play was an incomplete pass. That ruling is under further review.
We'll take a look just to be sure. Of course, the arm is coming forward, and it appeared to be. The ruling was correct.
What's the official closer than look like? We can ask Bill, but as soon as his arm, if there's any movement at all, Bill, where it's coming forward, that's, you're standing right there as a referee. You did it for how many years?
20 years in the Big Ten. This is the toughest call a referee has. You got to see if the ball is still in his control in his hand when he gets hit. This is close, but I think he still had barely control. Arm forward. I think they let the play stand minimally.
So as you're looking at this, you see that the arm coming forward, the hand. Anytime there's movement with the ball going back, obviously you get hit.
Right.
That's going to be a fumble. But as soon as it starts to come forward, and it just for a split second with possession of the ball, that's,
you're going to have a forward pass if that happens, Kirk. Okay.
The helmet of Rush hit the forearm and elbow of the quarterback, and Bill's right, it was pretty close.
But sure was. Bill, a question, if in the event that they were to say that it's a fumble, because the ball just, I don't even know what happened to the football. Was it recovered immediately?
The ball was recovered immediately. So if they were able to determine that this was a fumble, then Michigan State's going to get possession of the football.
If they
didn't, the spot,
if they
recovered,
didn't recover it immediately, then we just have, then even if it was a fumble, we would still just have
play stands.
Yeah, okay. Spartans jumped on the ball. I don't believe there was a whistle on that play. The official sort of let it go to see what would happen and then go and ruled it incomplete.
Yeah, I think John O'Neill, the referee, gave it a second look. The ball's out. I don't think he delayed his whistle to get an immediate recovery, but he delayed his whistle just to make sure in his mind he had a possession of a ball and an arm going forward.
Bill, loudest stadium in the Big Ten that you officiated in.
Wow, yeah, there's so many of them. Penn State, Michigan State, Michigan,
Michigan,
Wisconsin.
Yeah, Ohio State.
You know, Ohio State. Is that, are they in the Big Ten?
I believe so.
Bill did tell me, though, at halftime that the most intense rivalry that he refereed in was not Ohio State, Michigan, but Michigan State, Michigan. Had a nasty edge to it.
I think it's a little uglier, don't you?
Yeah.
Ohio State, typically Ohio State, Michigan, it's hard hitting, but it's not as nasty as you might see in the Michigan-Michigan State game.
You're going to see 60 minutes of intense interstate rivalry in that Michigan-Michigan
State. After further review, the ball was ruled a fumble with immediate recovery by the defense. Michigan State's ball.
Glad I asked that question.
They overturned it.
On the left hash.
Yeah, it was glad I asked that question about if was it immediately recovered.
Well, they overturned the rule of incompletion. They say that Rush's helmet got to the arm of Armstrong before it was going forward. Another look.
Boy, it's so close. I mean, here you have Bill, who officiated 20 years in the Big Ten, and there's the immediate recovery by Riley Bulla.
So Riley Bulla, the sophomore linebacker, younger brother of Max, the third generation Spartan. The guy's getting more and more playing time as a sophomore. He was a running back a year ago, back up to Langford, makes the recovery, and the Spartans take over at the 15-yard line. It's Langford spinning for a short gain. So three turnovers for each team now.
This defense is doing all that it can for Nebraska to try to keep them in this game. But when your offense is struggling as badly as this Nebraska offense is, it really has an impact eventually on your own defense. It's like, how many times are we going to be able to go out here and try to make a play to try to keep us in the game? It could become very draining on this unit.
For sure. Langford on second and eight, tries the middle again, still on his feet. And now Trevor Roach and company grab him for a 3-yard gain down to the 10. It'll be third down.
It's a Nebraska defense that doesn't have a lot of seniors. at all. I mean, if you look in their front four, there aren't any seniors. I mean, Randy Gregory theoretically could come back, and right now Bo Pelini and his staff feel that he needs more seasoning, and he probably will come back. But for as young as they are, they're holding up pretty good against a pretty good offense led by Connor Cook.
See if the Spartans can convert. They need five, just one of 10 tonight. Cook drops back. Looks in the end zone, fires high, and incomplete. It was over the head. Woodbridge. So they don't convert the fumble recovery into a touchdown. Fourth and five. Here comes a short field goal attempt.
And Connor Cook would love to have just a split second more time to be able to make that throw. Interesting how they're moving that pocket a lot. Connor Cook, an underrated athlete.
It was almost a freeze option look, wasn't it?
It was a speed option, play action look, and it's just to move him away from the potential blitz and pressure. And he had not quite enough time, but he was able to at least give it a shot there in the back of the end zone.
27-yarder for Geiger. And that's very easy. The guy who's missed just two field goals in his two-year career. So, Nebraska turnover converted.
GX, dare to be spontaneous. And AT&T, mobilizing your world.
On a rainy night in East Lansing, the Spartans have stretched it to 20-0. The replay reversal giving them a fumble in plus territory. And you said it well, Kirk. This Nebraska defense is, they're doing their best, taking the ball away, trying to prevent turnovers from becoming touchdowns. They're still down 20, and unless they can get number 8 loose, it's a long mountain to climb.
I mean, think about it. Not only have they been put in some tough situations, Connor Cook 7-21.
Yeah.
And they're holding up their end of the bargain tonight defensively.
After the touchback, then we'll take over. Back to Robert Flores for an update. I love the use unis there, Miami, with the orange and green look.
Michigan.
Yeah, it's a score of interest. 26-24. And Piscataway, Rutgers adds to Michigan's misery. Armstrong on the keeper. Knocked down after a short game by Marcus Rush again.
Assignment football early when it looked like Nebraska had an idea how they wanted to attack. I talked about how Michigan State had to use that, you know, the eye discipline of the safeties and the linebackers and play assignment football, and they've done such a great job of taking away Armstrong and Abdullah in this running game.
Armstrong fires far side, pass caught by Westerkamp for a first down near the 45, stopped by Drummond. It really contained Kenny Bell. And Armstrong once again getting up and limping. He's a tough guy. Grew up in Mississippi. The family home was destroyed by Hurricane Katrina, so he moved to Texas. Won a state championship there. Malcolm Brown, the Texas running back, was in the same backfield. And Abdullah, this is his longest run of the night. Couldn't quite break free, but stretches near a first down at the 48.
But it's
his best run.
Yeah, it's just great to see him have a little bit of a lane to work with. This defense has done such a good job of bottling him up. And that time is one of the few times you see the vision in the cutback lane there.
Abdullah again hit hard. He crosses midfield and has a first down. Of course, Kirk, with the zone read scheme, if you don't have the eye discipline you talked about, if you bust an assignment, 8 can take it 50, 60 yards in a hurry and perhaps change the game, but they have been so sound on that defensive side tonight. And
There's a throw again. He seems to really be anxious, Armstrong, pressing tonight, inaccurate on some short throws.
Well, he's just rushing it. And the reason he's rushing it is, how would you like to be out there wearing that number four jersey against these green jerseys? I mean, he is allowing the intensity and the success that Michigan State's defense has had to get him where his mind is working really, really fast. And when you do that, it's going to affect your feet. It's going to affect your accuracy.
Complete across the middle. Catch made down to the 35-yard line. Westerkamp has become the main weapon. Belknap in there.
Well, finally, behind the linebackers. Right there, the linebackers bite up on Abdullah. There's a beautiful window right behind him. And this time he has time to throw. He's in rhythm. And he finds Westerkamp behind those linebackers attacking downhill. I would continue to go into that area as often as you can with the linebackers coming downhill.
Their first down throw, and again, what you talked about, just a little anxious rushing things.
Well, then you start to aim it. You know, you start to miss one or two of those easy throws, and then you're going to start to try to be too perfect, and now he's aiming it. Instead of just getting back there, he's made that throw 1,000 times, and now he's thinking about it. When you start to think about easy things, like throwing the football, then it becomes even tougher to do.
Armstrong fires incomplete, short, excellent coverage. Let's get into Heather for the latest on Kenny Bell's status.
Yeah, you're talking about Nebraska's offensive struggles. They are without wide receiver Kenny Bell, who was injured in the second quarter, injured his left groin, has been called questionable, but guys, has not returned to action so far.
Heather, that means Jordan Westerkamp and Alonzo Moore are going to have to step up, obviously.
They need 10 on third down. A far side throw, and it's Westerkamp again, first down at the 15-yard line, and that was a nice cross-field throw.
It sure was. They try to confuse them with the pressure that they brought, and that is a long throw. Steps into it that time, Chris, and got the ball out of his hands quicker. And a great throw. He's been struggling on the balls to the outside, the quick throws. That time, he puts that ball right on the money to pick up the first down.
Terrell Newby, the sophomore in the game, shifting out of the pistol formation. Armstrong chased again and just fires it away far side. And here comes the flag for intentional grounding. That time, both defensive ends for the Spartans met at the quarterback, Calhoun and Rush. This looks pretty clear cut.
First foul for intentional grounding. An eligible receiver, number 84, was in the vicinity.
The Spartans won't like the flag that the flag is picked up.
Quick, watch how quick Alonzo Moore opens up here. And again, it's easy to see from up here. It's a young quarterback right there. If he throws it right now, and I thought he might be looking at him off of that play fake. If he would have been looking right there, he was open for a second or two. And that's a touchdown if he's able to recognize that. He's all alone in the end zone.
Well, he sure was. And his head was turned in that direction, but he was looking at Allen on the outside. So second and 10. Flag picked up. Abdullah's back in the backfield. Armstrong puck fake. Tries to scramble away again. Drop one more time. Calhoun and Taiwan Jones, the middle linebacker, combining.
It looks like Abdullah misses his block here off to the right against Calhoun, but I think he's trying to set up a little slip screen. The problem with the slip screen is 34, Twan Jones sniffed it out. He was waiting for it. There was nowhere to go at all for the quarterback, Tommy Armstrong.
You lost four.
Left tackle.
Third and 14, and again a false start as the problems for that Nebraska O-line continue.
Offense number 71. Penalty, still third down.
Both tackles for the Huskers, Lewis and Sterup, have had a nightmare evening.
Well, they're trying to get out. They know what's coming.
Yep.
They're trying to jump the count themselves because Rush on one side, Calhoun on the other. Never mind when they blitz the linebackers. Eddie Davis, when he blitzes, it seems like he's in cahoots with the center trying to jump the snap count. I mean, Ed Davis, I've never seen a guy as consistently getting off of at the snap on third down like number 43.
You know, it's Buller showing pressure off the edge. He backs off on third and 19. Empty backfield. They rush four.
Armstrong fires low. It was behind Abdullah and almost intercepted by Drummond at the goal line. Fourth down.
They're just trying to find any way they can to isolate Abdullah. And if he can't run the football, why not try to get him matched up against the linebacker and see if he can beat him in man-to-man coverage? I'll tell you what, Max Bulla has quite a legacy here. Was an outstanding player, the glue of this defense for the last few years. But young Riley Bulla, moving over from running back to linebacker, only a sophomore, really starting to like this Darian Harris, Twan Jones, Ed Davis, and Riley Bulla. Another great group of linebackers this year.
Bulla says, Max was smarter than me, but I'm more physical. I'm tougher than my big brother.
And he can run.
Drew Brown gets Nebraska on the scoreboard. Not what they were looking for, obviously. Just a field goal in the lead, 17, midway third. Robert, they can't wait for that. The way things are going right now, Michigan beginning Big Ten play 0-2 for the first time in 47 years, says researcher Chris Palika. Almost a half century. Now you're start underdogs tonight.
Now you got to start digging for what games remain in their schedule that are winnable.
Now Jay Shelton at the 5. Knocked down at the 17. Next Friday night on ABC, the series premiere of the acclaimed new comedy, Cristela, 8:30 Eastern Time, Friday night on ABC. Hey. I have to apologize to Mr. Felica, by the way. I have to apologize to him and to Duffy Doherty. I was given bad information, not by the Bear. Duffy Doherty did finish over 500 in his excellent state coaching career against Michigan. 10-7-2. Folks on Twitter called me out correctly so on that.
So that walk-off answer?
Yeah, he was exactly
that,
right.
That half-second quick walk-off answer.
Real serious.
Dead serious was right.
Hey, you're right about Michigan, by the way. You figure at Michigan State, at Ohio State, probably going to lose both those
games.
That's
two L's.
They're going to have to win out at 2-4. That'll put them 2-6.
That's the voice of the Bear predicting a dire year for the Maize and Blue. Hill.
Bear, who do they have left to play?
Well, they have the two road games, obviously, at Ohio State.
No, those are two.
Michigan,
that's two L's.
Michigan State. So we're going to have to win. They have a game in Northwestern that they still have.
They got a shot there.
So that's 6-6, probably best case scenario.
All of a sudden, Northwestern, by the way, you called correctly the win over Wisconsin. They beat Penn State in the road. They handle Wisconsin at home. Nobody was really talking about the Wildcats in the West, and here they are.
How about the Bears officially made it when Pat Fitzgerald, the head coach of Northwestern, gives him a shout out on Twitter today for picking Northwestern. That's how the Bears' life has changed. Bear.
Not in a good way, by the way. We get a rain event.
Bear.
Yes, sir.
That's how much your life has changed. The head coach who won the game.
Hey, I appreciate them making me look smart. Their D's played great the last couple of weeks. Forced a lot of turnovers. Did a good job against the pass game. Gordon had a big game, but they didn't do anything.
You know when you've made it, when coaches notice that you picked against them, then they use that to motivate their team, right?
I'm aware of that as well. The Miami fans have made me well aware of that from last week, that's for sure.
Bear, you had a big day today.
I did. I had TCU as well.
You had every game.
We had a nice start to the day in Oxford, Mississippi at the Grove, one of our favorite game days ever. Now we get to watch Big Ten football, Michigan State making a statement, and perhaps another undefeated team falling in Nebraska. Cook throws it near sideline. Lippitt makes a man miss. Hit hard, but he's across the 40 for a first down. Lippitt, of course, had the 55-yard touchdown catch in the first half.
Soft coverage on third and short. Cook just takes that. That's a matchup that he's going to be able to win. And wasn't necessarily soft coverage. It was just a good job by Lippitt at the top of his route, coming back, working back downhill. And again, when 18 and 14 are in sync, it's very, very challenging and tough for any defense to be able to deal with him. And again, they move him away from that pressure on third down.
With that big catch in the first half, he's now got a 100-yard game on just three catches. Set eye and Hill takes the catch. Connor Cook talking about finishing what they didn't do earlier in the year at Eugene.
looking back at it, we played a great first half, didn't play that good of a second half. So, you know, I think the main thing looking at it is to finish. That's the first thing that I wrote down on my goal card this week was at the very top was finish, finish, finish. So I think, you know, once the time comes on Saturday and it's 8 p.m. and it's kickoff and we're out there playing, I think the main thing that I'm going to be thinking about, you know, each and every series is just to finish. So I think as long as we do that, I think everything else will take care of itself.
You won't be too concerned about his stats, which at first glance don't look very impressive. 8 of 22. Empty backfield on second and eight. This is a different look. The Spartans have five receivers. He'll pump fake. Cook was going to take off, but he's trapped for a sack. McMullen, the defensive end, wouldn't let him get away.
I mean, some outstanding athletic ability in the interior there. Malik Collins, you're right. There was a little bit of a different look. You see an empty. You only have five offensive linemen there. Not the most mobile quarterback. These guys are coming after that Michigan State offensive line. And Malik Collins, only a sophomore. We've called his name out tonight more than any other Nebraska defender, even Randy Gregory. This guy doesn't get a lot of attention, but he should.
Well, the Nebraska front four has sort of done its job.
Without a doubt.
They've limited the running game.
They talk about their front being their strength.
So it's third and long. Cook well protected this time. Chucks it downfield in a beautiful throw. Catch made by McGarrett Kings for a first down. And again, Cook showing the arm talent and the touch.
And the ball placement by this young man is amazing. We haven't seen it on display a ton tonight, but this time he's given plenty of time on third down. He puts it right over the shoulder of his receiver. And offensive line does an outstanding job, as I said.
That is sweet,
huh?
That
is perfect. I mean, just perfect. Putting the ball right where Kings can make that play.
Second catch for Kings. The stats are improving, a 200-yard game now. And here comes the reverse. Lippitt's got the ball, and he's got the edge. Tony Lippitt scooting, 20, 10, cuts it back, goes in standing up. And they're having fun in East Lansing now. All smiles from the quarterback, Tony Lippitt, his second touchdown, one receiving and that one running on the double reverse.
That's about as well designed double reverse as you're going to see. You might not even be able to do it that well in practice. You got a fast flowing defense that overcommits one way, reverse comes back the other way. Even a quarterback got in on the act. He hasn't blocked that well probably in his life. Came up with a great block.
Geiger makes it 27-3.
Keep an eye on the quarterback because, honestly, in film on Sunday and Monday, they're going to talk to him about that. Wasn't necessarily a dominating block, but he took Josh Kalu out. Look at the wall, and look at the tight end, Paul Lang, all the way downfield, 30 yards, opening up that last block for a touchdown. That's a good look.
Cook made the block, but you're right, Kirk. That was just perfect timing and execution by all of the Spartans in that point.
Yeah, and the timing there by Dave Warner on when to pull the trigger and say, you know what, I'm seeing some things, guys, and I think this might work right now. And one of the things he's seen is we talked all night, Nebraska's defense has been playing well. The front's been flowing and making plays. Linebackers. And when you have a group that's overcommitted, one way obviously to slow them down is to come back with a reverse.
Lippitt's first career rushing touchdown. Already this year he's got seven touchdown receptions. And the low line drive kick is another touchback.
Yeah, well, again, this is just perfectly designed. This is the key block. We're kidding a little bit with the quarterback, but that's a key block because Josh Kalu, once he goes down, if you pull back, you'll see downfield. These linemen, it's like a convoy and what they did. gave him plenty of room, like set up a wall down that right side. And the final block by the tight end, Paul Lang. That's a lot of fun for a quarterback because he knows he's going to get a ton of love from his coaches and teammates showing a willingness to block when he looks at the film of that.
And then R.J. Shelton knocked him down with the midair bump. Yeah. So Nebraska in a huge hole, final couple minutes of the third quarter. Armstrong pump fakes, looks downfield, has a man wide open, and the drop by Westerkamp. Nothing but green grass in front of him.
That play really kind of sums up the night. It looks like the defense, one of the few times we've seen a bust, a breakdown with Curtis Drummond and Twan Jones. They both kind of covered the same area. I'd rather Darian Harris covering the same area and a little wheel route where it looked like Westerkamp might be blocking and he just kind of snuck down the sidelines. Well designed, they just didn't execute.
Now they swing it to Abdullah in the flat. He's got some room. He's got a first down. Wet night, not easy to hold on to the football, but that was a play Nebraska needed to make.
Yeah, I mean, remember, we're still early in this season. It's not just about this game right now. I mean, they're not going to come back and win this game, but you are still trying to compete. You're still trying to fight. You're still trying to find things that work for next week and the week after.
Armstrong again throws up the back foot as Westerkamp open again. Spartans beginning to get a little lax in the secondary, and then play moves it down inside the 40.
Yeah, that's the second time here on this drive alone that we've seen some mistakes, and what's incredible is the pressure got there again. Joel Heath ends up getting there, getting the pressure, but the quarterback, I mean, what are you going to do? Armstrong, he throws it up there, but it was a blown coverage, and he ends up making a play, and that's two in a row, the last two plays we've seen.
They throw far side. Too high for Allen, too short for Westerkamp.
Somewhere in between there. Tommy Armstrong is a guy that Bo Pelini's going to have to build his offense around, and that's why how he reacts to this environment and this setting down 24, Bo fired up. It's something I think they're evaluating as we speak, and we'll continue to look at. I want to see how he competes and the decisions he makes. This is his team.
Took over when Martinez got hurt last year. His only loss as a starter was to Michigan State a year ago in Lincoln. Abdullah has had a very, very frustrating night. The fumble and the wildcat run in the first half. 18 rushes for 34 yards, that's under 2 per carry. Guy was averaging 7.3 coming in. It's been a nightmare on third down.
They move him out again, trying to get a matchup against the linebacker.
He's in the slot on the right side. Fired incomplete. And now it's fourth down. 39 seconds in the third quarter. Pearson Elm with Hicks tracking him closely there.
At this point on fourth down, they've got to go, and Jordan Westerkamp in the slot at the top will be the guy that more than likely they're going to be trying to get the football to.
Again, Heather reporting to Kenny Bell. Clearly their top receiver with a groin injury. They didn't rule him out, but he has not returned, and further problems for the quarterback, who fumbles the snap and on fourth down just has to fall on that sort of symbolic, and now a conversation with the center there.
It's because he wasn't ready for the snap. The ball came up and he wasn't anticipating the snap. He was looking at coverage. The ball just happened to hit him right in the hands. You see his eyes? He's looking now to his left. He was looking to his right. Boom. Ball comes back.
Fortunately, Mark Pelini, the coach's nephew.
Yeah. I mean, look at him. There's a good look at his eyes. He has no idea the ball's coming back. It's on a fourth down play.
And that is a uncle to a nephew, and it's not a pleasant exchange. Ugh. You don't want to be on the wrong end of one of those Pelini tirades. There you go.
Jerry with the tackle. McCurk enjoyed the comfort of the All-State bus here. Saturday Night Football has joined us here in East Lansing. All-State It's Good sweepstakes. Chance to win $100,000 plus a VIP trip to the college football playoff semifinal game at the All-State Sugar Bowl and the national championship game as well. Weekly prizes throughout the season.
It's one grand prize winner. It's all that.
End of the third quarter in a soggy evening in East Lansing, but a happy one for the host, 27-3. Back after this message and a word from your local ABC station. Beginning of the fourth quarter, Michigan State in total command with the football up 27-3, having just scored on a double reverse on the previous possession. But they vowed to finish. So if Dave Warner is true to his word, you can see more aggressive play calling in the final quarter. And they are going to throw it. But rolls and fires incomplete. Is back behind Burbridge. Michigan State's next two games at Purdue next week, then at Indiana, and then Michigan comes here October 25th. So as you look ahead, you make them clearly favorites in those two road games. You'd have to love their chances against the Wolverines and Ohio State, the big ABC game on November the 8th here.
Oh no, you think they can go to West Lafayette? Get a win. It should be good.
Like
there.
Their chances.
Yeah, they'll be all right. Their whole season will come down to November 8th.
Cook on third down swings it to Langford. A little stiff arm, but he's brought down. Good tackle by Zaire Anderson for a short gain, and it's fourth down.
Really, I mean, when the season before a game was played, I think everybody looked at November 8th as a game that not only could decide the Big Ten Eastern Division, but could have huge ramifications on teams trying, those two teams trying to get in to the Big Ten Championship and ultimately into the Final Four.
JT Barrett and the Buckeyes, a big win at Maryland and the Terrapins' Big Ten debut at home. He'll be tested, Barrett, when he comes in here, but you the way that he's improved after the Rocky game against the Hokies. Sadler, and this one will be returned. Pearson L cuts it up, and the true freshman accelerates into Michigan State territory and knocked down at the 43. So again, Nebraska has great starting field position. They have not been able to capitalize tonight. A 33-yard return for the freshman. Robert, thank you. The craziness of today just continuing tonight. Two more surprises. Nebraska takes over after the punt return of the plus 43. Two Hail Marys involving the two Arizona schools to win in recent weeks. Armstrong escapes, darts forward, and stutter steps, knocked down at the 32. It's a first down carry. He is slow to get up. Took a shot in the leg and hip area, holding that thigh.
Well, Chris, it really looked like Ed Davis, who came in late it wasn't the safety coming up to make the play. I think it was as he was going down, Ed Davis, not here with the freshman Nicholson, but right there, that hit.
Nothing dirty about it. Davis arrived. Quarterback hadn't yet gone down. He's holding his midsection. And like Riker Fife, the sophomore from Grand Island, Nebraska, the backup, is up, warming up.
They get Davis just coming in to finish the play, coming in violently. I mean, he's coming in with a lot of speed. It looks like his right leg, maybe the right knee, went into the midsection of Armstrong.
Ford F-150 and Transformers Age of Extinction. Own it today on Blu-ray Combo Pack, rated PG-13.
Good news is that Tommy Armstrong got up and walked off, appeared to be okay, laying down over there as the trainers talked to him. Focuses on his midsection, but didn't appear to be anything too serious.
Tough guy, really hard worker.
So we'll see.
Yeah, players really respect him.
We'll see the sophomore Riker Fife, who's thrown seven passes this year so far, completed three, and immediately miscommunicates with Westerkamp on that one. A flag is down as the quarterback was pressured. It's in that holding zone.
Personal foul, hands in the face, defense number 92, 15 yards from the previous spot, automatic first down.
So it's on Joel Heath, who got his hand up in a lineman's face.
Five catches a break, but first play, he's been sitting, it's pretty cold and windy down there. He's been sitting down there all day. This is where you find out how much a backup quarterback, even though he doesn't have a lot of reps, how much he's been getting mental reps watching. Right. Tommy Armstrong try to go out and execute this offense.
Penalty moves the ball to the 17, a first down. Abdullah takes it to him. Five fired over Osterkamp's head, had him breaking open. Heather?
Chris, look for a new quarterback. Tommy Armstrong has just been cleared by the team doctors to return to action. He said he landed on a ball and had a midsection injury, but he's just come up to the coaching staff and told them that he can check back in.
Gotta love that, Heather. I mean, you'd think, oh, you know what, it's been a rough night, 13 minutes to go, they're down 24, you know, just call tonight, get ready for next week. It tells you what kind of leader he is. He's been cleared, he wants to come back and keep competing with his guys.
Let's see if they put him back in. Fife rolls out, delivers, complete. Westerkamp dives out of bound, a couple yards short of the first down.
You know, the last play, he made a great decision. Again, on the bench all night for three quarters, comes in, makes a great decision, just threw the ball high, missed a touchdown, comes right back, and this time, again, makes another good decision, puts the ball out there where his receiver can make a play on the ball.
Third and two. Abdullah hammers forward for a first and goal to the five-yard line. So Nebraska is trying to finally find the end zone with the backup quarterback at the helm. After the game, except on the West Coast, your late local news for most of these ABC stations. ESPN2 will have SportsCenter coming up after the game. Abdullah down to the two. Nothing has been easy for number eight tonight. Came in here as a prime Heisman candidate, limited to 36 rushing yards so far, on 19 carries. That time, he plows straight ahead and finds the end zone. Nebraska cutting into the lead early in the fourth quarter.
And that is a really good job by Riker Fife coming in and finishing this drive off, which has been a really challenging thing for this offense to do tonight. He hit the pass, got him down closer. Of course, they convert on third and two. And then they're finally able to get the ball into the end zone tonight for their first touchdown of the evening.
They're going to go for two here to try to cut this to a 16-point margin. It'd be a two-score game. You have to believe that Fife hasn't worked a whole lot on their two-point play. Bring a man in motion. And a miscommunication, tried to hand it off to Abdullah. And Spartans have had a pounce on it. So Nebraska finds the end zone. Their backup quarterback running the show. Two-pointer fails. 27-9. Saw Mark D'Antoni with an angry reaction. He's not a guy with a permanent scowl. You sort of associate that facial expression. He's actually a pretty nice guy, really good sense guy, of humor. Yeah. But he wants his team to finish. And you know he doesn't want any drop in intensity, even with the big fourth quarter lead. This is Shelton. Knocked down just across the 20-yard line. Our Pacific Life game summary.
It's been a rough night, obviously, for Amir Abdullah. Michigan State came in determined to stop him, take him out of the game plan for Nebraska. Pretty successful. 21 carries, only 41 rushes, just scored that touchdown. But it's been a long night for him, obviously. Connor Cook, on the other hand, hasn't necessarily hit a lot of passes, but when he has, it's typically to Tony Lippitt. Over 100 yards receiving for Lippitt, and Connor Cook is now at this point in the game just looking to work the clock and manage this game and make his coach smile. Right, Chris?
He will smile occasionally. You give it to Langford running right in a short game. You know, it's fun sometimes to be able to present the trophies at bowl games. I was down there in Pasadena when Mark D'Antoni was presented that Rose Bowl trophy, and you know what a culmination that was, yeah, for him. I mean, it'd been decades since Spartan fans could celebrate like that. And on top of the fact that he turned around the head-to-head with Michigan, he's won 5 out of 7 against the Wolverines. They were 2-9 in the 11 years before he got there against Michigan.
Yeah. Well, he's as he told us this week, he's created such a different culture here than was here when he first got to Michigan State. About discipline and commitment and sacrifice.
Cook, a dangerous throw, far side, it's incomplete. Yeah, we asked him, what do you want your program to stand for? And he said, grounded, not entitled, be tough, trust each other, play with great effort.
And it's one thing to get that when your team has a chip on its shoulder, because Michigan State, just for years, they've had this major chip on their shoulder trying to get respect from the Michigans and the Ohio States and whoever it might be. So it's one thing to get a group of guys to have a chip on their shoulder, to have those that fundamental understanding. But when you win a Big Ten championship and you win a Rose Bowl, now it becomes a different set of challenges, right, to try to keep them motivated.
And third down, again, the throw incomplete. The receiver well jammed, and now a flag comes in late. A couple of flags coming in. A little bit of a scuffle on the line after the play as you see some of D'Antonio's accomplishments. A 691 winning percentage.
That's impressive.
Three of the last four, 11-plus wins. On track, of course, for that again this year. Becoming the favorites to win this conference.
Unsportsmanlike conduct. Offense number 66. That's a second unsportsmanlike conduct. By rule, he is disqualified.
So Jack Allen, who was out injured against Wyoming, they get him back tonight. It has been kicked out for a second unsportsmanlike conduct foul. Two in a game, and here's what happened. 66 there, middle of the screen, battling with Gregory, and he shoves the defender to the ground, kind of gets the knee up into the face mask, and he tries to claim it was an accident. I'm not buying it.
Well, he's known as a tough guy, and he's got to have it. You know, he's been around, played a lot of football. He's got to be smart. And he can disagree with it all that he wants, but that's something that he cannot do. I mean, it's one thing to be up 27-9. That's what's going to get his head coach fired up.
Sadler, low punt, drives it into the wind well, and it rolls dead at the 41-yard line. Knuckleball from the versatile punter. Chick-fil-A, top 10, Florida State slugged past Wake Forest after a slow start. We talked about Oregon's loss to Arizona at home on Thursday night. Ole Miss in a magical finish, taking out Alabama with a late interception in the end zone to seal it. TCU, 37-33 in Fort Worth over Oklahoma. There were 17 unbeaten, Kirk, in college football before this weekend started. You can see they are just beginning to drop away in early October.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see who is able to hold on. Think about this now. We may have just a bunch of one-loss teams at the end of this thing.
Where's TCU going to move up? They were 25th. They are at Baylor next week in Waco.
Yep.
Interesting. Armstrong back in there as the Huskers take over, and he finds Westerkamp on the slant. Drummond muscles him down at the 41, and this is not what D'Antoni wants to see from his team in the finishing department, is it?
No, not at all. Middle mistake by his starting center. Defense already gave up a few plays. They gave up a touchdown. I mean, and this is a team that said, what did we learn about Oregon? We need to finish, whether we're up or we're down. We want to be a team that plays four quarters of football.
Armstrong fires into traffic. There is just not a sliver of space between the receiver and Darian Hicks. Joel Heath was pressuring him.
I'm just going to go back to Tommy Armstrong and the fact that he's back out there. I mean, this team was down and out. They are still down and out. There's every reason after you get a big injury in the fourth quarter to just kind of say, you know what, it's been one of those days. Don't worry about it. We're going to have Riker Fife finish this off. But instead, being the leader that he is, he comes back out and he wants to finish this game. And now let's see if he can try to put another touchdown up on the board.
Spins out. A flag is down as Armstrong just heaves into the end zone. Jump ball falls incomplete. Looked like they were trying to hold one of the pass rushers, and that's what it'll be against Nebraska. Marcus Rush has just been all over the quarterback, and it's been a nightmare for guys like Alex Lewis, the left tackle.
Holding, offense number 71, 10 yards from the previous spot, repeat second down.
It's because he's played so much football. It's, you know, he's going to come to the outside with speed, but his hands are what make him so special to me. The guy that's played a lot of football, he's learned a lot of different tricks. It's not just about being a fast guy, it's about getting those hands of the offensive tackle off of you as quickly as you can, and he uses it almost to help him accelerate by the left tackle who's holding him.
Five sacks for this defensive line. They've drawn holding penalties, they've drawn false starts. Lester Kemp makes a catch, dragged down by Drummond. It'll set up a very manageable third down call, though.
They're getting the ball out and they're getting the ball thrown vertically. You know, they, in the first half when they were struggling, even when they were throwing, a lot of their throws were horizontal, just quick throws to the outside. Now the ball is still coming out quickly, but it's downfield in some one-on-one matchups against these safeties.
Westerkamp with eight catches. He had 16 in the season coming in. Armstrong fires low, incomplete for Alonzo Moore. So it's fourth down and six.
He is getting so much pressure. It's just hard for him to step into his throws. And it's something that Bo Pelini and Tim Beck both talked to us about. He's only a sophomore. He's running a kind of an option-oriented offense. But when he gets put into a position when the running game's not working, and he's back there in the pocket throwing, his technique is still growing. He's still not quite there where he needs to be. Consequently, a lot of his throws are erratic.
Media pressure. Armstrong fired, incomplete. Tariq Allen claiming that he was grabbed, and now a flag comes in very late. Both teams losing their composure a bit here in the fourth quarter. This will be a dead ball foul. Huskers are pointing at Ed Davis. I mean, it was fourth and six. The possession was going to change.
After the play was over, dead ball, unsportsmanlike conduct, 89 defense. Michigan State will retain possession of the ball after the enforcement of the penalty.
So it's on Calhoun. Because it was after the play and the fourth down pass was incomplete, the Spartans will have the ball. Be backed up 15 yards. So Michigan State takes over on downs, although they're still out there talking about things. Free Oregon thing. Number, thank you. Spartans go back to work. Four straight years, by the way, UCLA has lost the game before Oregon. The Ducks visit the Rose Bowl next Saturday in an early hole there. And the craziness just continues. If you missed it, Kentucky over Steve Spurrier and the Gamecocks tonight. Arizona State on a Hail Mary in the Coliseum. Mark Stoops and the Cats are 4-1.
4-1 in the East.
There's never been a day like this in the state of Mississippi.
No.
The Bulldogs hammer the Aggies in Starkville. 75 miles as the crow flies to the northwest. Ole Miss ends a 10-year skid against Alabama today. Wow. Langford running wide, gets a first down after the 35-yard line. This is a day they'll talk about for a long, long time in college football. If you're a favorite, if you're an unbeaten like Notre Dame, for example, who dodged the upset, consider yourself very, very favored. Oklahoma went down in Fort Worth as well. Auburn took care of business at home against an LSU team that is looking like one of the cellar dwellers in the SEC West.
What Mississippi State did to Texas A&M with Dak Prescott was so impressive today.
Bigger than the score indicates, right?
Yeah, much bigger. And then what Ole Miss did and the way they fought back and came back to win that game and then held on for a victory against Alabama and Nick Saban. I mean, and all that within one state, in a state that's been notorious near the bottom of the SEC West for both of those
illegal
teams.
Illegal motion. Offense.
They tried to hand it to Shelton. He would not stop before the ball was snapped, so that'll back him up 5 yards. Well, this was our bucket list college game day. Finally hit the ground. Why did you include the top right there? That was uncalled. That was a little bit of a visual gag with the SEC bro bangs. Katy Perry was one of the most entertaining guest pickers ever.
She was.
And she called the upset today.
She sure did. And Colonel Sanders joined us up there in that picture.
Oh, man. Those 10 acres down there in Oxford crowded with about 50,000 people. The scene unlike any other. And some moments unlike any other in that show. And the Rebels cap it off with a win. Langford running wide to the left. Gregory and the Huskers defense still showing a lot of hustle.
I mean, I like to think I've seen a lot of tailgating in our days of being out in college football.
You've never tailgated. You're too
busy.
Well,
but I mean, you walk by it. You see it.
Okay.
But I've never, ever seen anything like what we just witnessed down there. They set up tents 8 o'clock on Friday night. And then they have chandelier lighting underneath the tents. How do you describe what we saw?
Yeah, it's a way of life. But you get there, you make the sprint for the land grab. You got to hire some students, which is what a lot of them do, to save their space.
Claim your territory.
You know what, though, Kirk? You have a day like this where Ole Miss finally beats Alabama. The catch is made on the far side. Verbrick's knocked down into the Nebraska bench, but he did hold on. You have a day like that to cap it. That is a memory that they'll talk about for 100 years. Generations will talk about being in Oxford today.
It was going to be a fun story. Hey, tough loss against Alabama, but instead it's even a better memory because of the game. What a great catch there. And again, a perfectly thrown ball.
Ends up on a trash can in the bench there.
You know, we've talked a lot about Lippitt, but if Michigan State's going to do special things this year and try to win out and win a Big Ten championship, the development, ongoing production from Mumphrey and Burbridge and Shelton and Kings
charge time on
are
Michigan
huge.
State.
They've got to continue to develop those guys because, you know, against the better defenses, they're going to try to take away Lippitt, and someone else has got to be willing and able to make those plays.
Where would you put Michigan State? Now, you give them credit for scheduling Oregon on the road. They did end the game with a 28-zip run against them. Oregon now has taken a loss. How much does Michigan State, which was ranked 10th coming in, move back up after all these teams ahead of them have lost this weekend?
Well, I think for them and any team that's going to have a loss, the earlier that you have that loss, more games that you have, a chance to kind of kind of get yourself out of that hole. The problem is with that graphic is zero top 25 wins, mm-hmm. and the only remaining team that's going to give them any kind of wow factor is if they beat Ohio State November 8th, and then depending on what happens and who they play in a Big Ten championship game, if they make it there. So when that's your resume, and you look at strength of schedule, I think it was 51.
This would be one ranked win with Nebraska.
Yeah. 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 Well, we'll see where they end up ranked. But then you look at these other teams that they're trying to catch up to, right. and you look at their schedule and their strength of schedule. I think Michigan State's a great team, but it's going to be, if they went out, they're going to be in the debate. But the thing that could hold them back is being in the Big Ten and playing the schedule they play.
Look at the timeout. Third and two. And hammering ahead for the first down. Heather?
You guys are talking about Michigan State's schedule and how they can hang or whether they can hang with that one loss. It's very interesting. Down on the field earlier today, they announced some scores. They announced the Alabama upset, and probably about 15 players looked up and cheered. Then they announced the Oklahoma upset. The exact same thing happened. So these players very plugged in, very well aware, and loving the fact that some of these top teams are getting a loss.
Heather, then they announced a Michigan score.
Yes.
got even louder down there.
But Heather makes a good point that the games will be increasingly interconnected. It's only the first week in October. It's been a long way to go. The committee doesn't even meet for 3 weeks.
But I think because the Big Ten nationally is just not as a respected conference as some of the others, that the loss to Oregon really hurts. And if they went out, they're going to have to look good doing it. Mm-hmm. They're going to have to not just win out. They're going to have to look really impressive to be able to get into the discussion and ultimately try to get up into the top four.
Kirk, if you're going to look at the teams that made breakthrough wins, had milestones today, Mississippi State, Ole Miss, TCU, which of those teams do you think has a chance to be, we could call them this year's Auburn, a team that was completely off the radar at the beginning of the season, ended up having sort of a magical season? Or is it someone other than those three teams? The sledding is so tough in the SEC West. I mean, these are just weekly wars. To survive it by anybody seems unlikely.
It sure does. I mean, even looking at Mississippi State and Ole Miss right now, you think about Ole Miss, congratulations, great win, biggest in school history. All right, see you next week. You're going to Texas A&M and Kyle Field, who just lost, and they're going to be backed into a corner. They need a win. So it is tough to imagine.
What about the guys from Starkville? Congratulations, you destroyed A&M. Here comes Auburn next week.
Right.
I mean, don't even think about bringing your A-minus game for that one, right?
Right. But to answer your question, I would say right now, you would say Ole Miss and Mississippi State feel like a team like Auburn did right now a year ago.
And third down, Cook, off play action, fires, almost intercepted, right into the hands of Josh Mitchell, who couldn't hold on to it in his fourth down.
But, you know, Gary Patterson's team had a look to them today that we haven't seen in a few years. They you know, they've got a quarterback right now that's playing with confidence.
They want a shootout. That's not Gary's style.
No, but, I mean, they look athletic. They look like they used to look. They've been away for the last couple of years for a variety of reasons. But that was a monumental win for TCU. Since they joined the Big 12, they just had so many distractions. That game and that win's kind of off to the side a little bit with some of the other high-profile upsets.
Sadler's punt is a high one and a short one. Another reminder, Monday Night Football on ESPN. Mike Tirico, John Gruden, bringing Russell Wilson and the Seahawks. Probably the nation's capital will take on ex-Spartan Kirk Cousins and the Washington Redskins. 8:15 on ESPN, also on the Watch ESPN app. Cooks, get it with the aprons there, number 18?
Yeah.
And the chef's hats?
They don't have
the cleverness market cornered down in Oxford.
No, but you know what? At least they're still here. There are very few students still here gutting it out, but
the post-game festivities have begun.
I guess so.
Body.
I guess so.
It hasn't been a party for Armstrong tonight. He runs free, fires. There's a flag down. It's incomplete on the far side. Marker was on the near side, just beyond the line of scrimmage. It's going to be offsides.
Offside, defense, number 98. 5-yard penalty, repeat first down.
Yeah, there's a student there. Section. Yeah, there they aren't. there are probably some beverages being consumed on this chilly evening. Most of the regular fans are still here.
Here are the diehards. They're the diehards right there.
Well, the ones who are underage, maybe.
You don't.
It's first and five. Maybe they figure this one's in hand, and they're probably not wrong. Oh, into traffic, and the catch is made, and Westerkamp is running free deep into Michigan State territory. Could have been a pick six the other way. The ball got through to the wide receiver. It's a big play for Nebraska.
Well, Curtis Drummond read the quarterback perfectly. He did everything he's supposed to do except catch the ball. I mean, that was perfect technique. Recognized the route, the throw. He almost baited him to almost say, hey, he's open. Look, make the throw. Stepped right in front of it, and then the ball just goes right through his hands. Pretty good concentration there by Westerkamp.
Armstrong flips it short. Catch made and knocked down his lane hubby right near the first down marker. This will not make D'Antonio or Narduzzi all that happy, will it, if Nebraska can punch this in?
No, not at all. I mean, they've dominated this game, and it's 27-9. And their defense has played great. We've talked on and on and on how well they've played.
But
it's not been the same defense the last two or three series.
Dula fights forward. It'll be a first down.
You say that, and if Drummond makes the pick six, and it's, you know, how great. But it's the little things. I mean, the difference, everything was perfect. It was the right call. He was in position. He just didn't squeeze the ball.
Another play card there for the Cornhuskers. That's an interesting composition. Stool.
Dominic
is that Sue up there in the upper?
I think so, yeah.
Okay. First down, Armstrong fires a missile, but it's high. And behind the receiver, now a flag comes in as Waynes was covering Alonzo Moore. A late flag. Ball was sailed way behind the receiver. It's getting a little sloppy for the Spartans here.
Pass interference, defense, number 15. Foul occurred in the end zone. By rule, automatic first down.
So Drummond could have had the pick six.
I'm
a couple plays later, it's Waynes with it. Interference.
Yeah, I don't agree with the call. That's
neither does he.
No, I don't even think the ball was catchable.
No, he moved it to the 2 yard line. First and goal. This is Abdullah trying for his second short touchdown run to make this look more respectable. He says little things, whether it's a lapse in concentration, Drummond not making the pick.
Yeah.
He's just trying to play fast, and Abdullah. He's had to earn every piece of real estate tonight. Muscles, no signal yet.
Quick signal down at the bottom.
Was there a signal?
Yeah, a quick one.
Okay. Yep. And here's a touchdown, his second touchdown run of the night. That's what it's been like. Just a mighty struggle. And then, he just reaches the ball out and falls across the goal line there before he hits the ground. So Abdullah, 45 rushing yards on 24 carries and two short touchdowns. He had the fumble on the Wildcat formation in the first half when the game was still in doubt.
So a drop pick six by Drummond, a questionable pass interference call on Wayans, and then a couple short runs by Abdullah, and it's a touchdown.
Now it's 11 points, and it's a two-possession game. Michigan State's offense has to play with some intensity with 4:10 to play. Tomorrow over on ESPN, the chase for the NASCAR Sprint Cup title goes into the contender round. 12 drivers, only 8 will advance. NASCAR Sprint Cup Series in Kansas tomorrow, 1 o'clock Eastern on ESPN. Antonio, you could talk about finishing, doing little things right, maintaining focus and effort, but it hasn't really happened on the lead here in the fourth quarter. 11 points with 4:10 to play.
No, and I guess on the other hand, anytime you can win a game and and be ranked in the top 10 of the country, and be able to be fired up like he is right now, and then go to the film room and be able to show guys proof about why you need to finish. Because guess what? When you don't finish, this is what happens. There's such a difference between being really mentally sharp in the first half and then maybe letting off a little bit of our intensity and our focus. And there's a big difference in how they perform from the first half to the second half.
Nebraska tries the onside kick here. The Spartans hands team is up and ready for it. Instead, they booted deep. And it's bouncing at the one-yard line, so Hill has to pick it up. And the coverage team flies down there and drops him at the 10. So the Spartan offense backed up. Nebraska does have all three timeouts. If they can get the ball back quickly, I suppose a sliver of hope is alive. She missed it. Video touchdown now posted on the SportsCenter app of Nebraska's score. Available on your mobile devices and tablets whenever you need it. There are a couple more highlights for the Big Red here tonight. There's a 68-yard five-play drive. So Langford dropped for a loss, flying through. Stay tuned for the Ford wrap-up show after the game with Robert Flores. Recap another eventful day, all the surprises and the late-day drama. Nebraska will spend one of its timeouts here at the 3:59 mark, trying to get the Spartans quickly off the field and get the ball back.
It's about controlling the clock at this point. And, you know, Jeremy Langford, who's had somewhat of a quiet night, 93 yards rushing. He has eight straight Big Ten games where he's rushed for over 100 yards.
Right.
So he's trying to make that nine straight tonight. But, you know, it's really, this is going to be one of those games where Michigan State wins this game. They go into the locker room, and it's right here. Listen to the coach. They're going to have to sing the fight song, but it's going to be, because they're going to be disappointed. This game just was not really what they envisioned. Even though they're going to win the game, there's going to be a lot to learn from and try to get better.
If the score holds, it'll be an 11th consecutive Big Ten win by double digits. Haven't really been pushed right down to a one-score margin in any of those games. Cook now under center on second and 11. In motion, they give it to Shelton. R.J. Shelton gets a couple of blocks, gets knocked down about 3 yards short of the first down. And Nebraska will call another timeout. So it all comes down to the Huskers trying to stop them on this third and short and get the ball back. At the moment, check the Big Ten standings, it's Northwestern that has to be one of the pleasant surprises in the conference. The road win over Penn State, the home win today over Wisconsin atop the West at 2-0. Nebraska, unless they can come back, will drop to 1-1.
Yeah, once Northwestern got out of the MAC and got into the Big Ten, they started to really come into their own.
Michigan State, if they hold on, will join Ohio State at 1-0. Top the East again. Very early going.
Honestly, yeah. Northwestern off to a really slow start. They lost Venrick Mark and Camp, who ended up getting out of his commitment there to Northwestern. And I think they've really, the last couple of weeks, going to Penn State. And then, of course, today, a huge win against Wisconsin.
And the Huskers come up with a stop. Spartans need 2 yards here on third down. Langford has it. Fighting. Still fighting. But won't get there. A yard short at the 19-yard line. And Nebraska, as Pelini sprints out there and emphatically uses their final timeout to save the clock. 3:37 to play. Huskers are going to get the ball back. Down 11, potentially really good field position.
Yeah, and the reason Bo is so fired up, he's trying to keep every single second that he can, is he's thinking about either try to block a punt, you get a good return, you get a quick score, and then you're an onside kick away,
yeah,
and a shot for a field goal.
And D'Antonio can do the math. He knows that it's not just, I think, a teaching moment for his team. I think, you know,
I just love
Nebraska has hope, and there's still some danger for Michigan State if they don't execute things well.
I just love the fighting mentality that Nebraska has, and not giving up. You know, they're trying to do everything they can to try to stay in this game.
See if they come after the punt. Sadler boots it low. Pearsonell driven back, but he catches it and has a crease. DeMornay Pearsonell is in open field. Look out! Nebraska has life! 62 yards! And the Cornhuskers close to within five.
We've bragged a lot about Mike Sadler, and this time it's a low punt. A line drive. Looked like he tried the rugby punt. And he didn't get any air underneath. He just wanted that ball. I think he just wanted to bounce and roll.
That's a second punt return touchdown of the season for this true freshman in Alexander, Virginia.
But Chris, the fact that he caught the football, he had a long way to go over to catch the ball. That was a brilliant move. And that's why Pelini's down there trying to get timeouts.
Yeah.
He believed in his team, and now a two-point conversion. This is big.
If they get this, it's a three-point game with 3:22 to play. High formation. D'Antonio chugs down in before the snap. The Spartans call
timeout, Michigan State.
37. He wanted to check the formation and set the two-point defense because he knows how big this play is.
Yeah, see, look how far he has to sprint. I mean, he went over there about 10 or 15 yards, makes that first guy miss, and then there's no one left. It's great blocking. He has such a natural feel as a punt returner when he gets out into the open space. And there's some guys that just have it. This guy has it. He makes the first guy miss. They set up that middle return. And boy, I mean, he hit that second and third gear, boom, right there, goodbye. Nobody's going to catch him. Low punt, trying to kick it away from him. Great effort. That's what Bo was trying to get that timeout in, because I thought he was either going for the block or a big return, and he ends up getting the big return.
Remember back when this was 27-3 and Tommy Armstrong was knocked out, we wondered if they're just going to save the quarterback. He wanted to get back in there.
He showed fight.
He believed at that point.
Pelini's shown fight. The defense has shown fight the entire game. Regardless of how this finishes for Nebraska, now this is something they can build on. We'll see what happens here.
A two-pointer again to cut the lead to three. Spartans shuffling around on the front. An option look. The late pitch to Abdullah, but he's dropped for a loss. And again, a little bit of shaky execution on Nebraska's two-point plays. They go 0-for-2 tonight, and the lead is still 5.
Jake Cotton, the left guard, is communicating with the cornerback. He's looking over, saying, what do we got here? All of a sudden, the ball snapped. Watch this. Ball snapped. He's still in his stance. It just didn't have a chance from the beginning. And I don't know if Jake Cotton, he's trying to get the call. You see Armstrong lucky to get the snap. He's trying to tell Jake Cotton what the call is or which way they're running the play. So there's confusion. The play just really never had a chance.
It's the second time Pelini has snapped the ball when Armstrong wasn't ready for it tonight. They're still talking about it over there. But fourth quarter touchdowns for Nebraska. And it's a five-point game. Now, they burned their timeouts, but there's still 3:22 to play. Do they kick it deep, or do they try an onside kick here?
Well, without any timeouts, it's a little bit of a different feel here than the last time they did this. I think you almost have to go with the onside kick.
Drew Brown is a true freshman kicker. Spartans reshuffling the hands team. Looks like it will be an onside kick. Oh, it did not come up. That was well handled. That's like a shortstop getting down to field it. And Curtis Drummond, who could have had the pick six, that would have sealed this thing, went through his hands, shorthanded there.
He went Derek Jeter on him there.
Yeah, didn't he?
Yeah,
it's a short hop.
He stayed down low. Tendency to want to come up on this ball, but he stays down.
Boy, if that ricochets off his knee.
And look who's right there. The best hands on the team for Nebraska, Jordan Westerkamp, is right about to close in on him trying to get that football. He's a great play by Drummond. As you said, he misses the interception to the pick six, but that time secures it, and that's why he's on the hands team.
So play clock running down. Michigan State Trying to chew this clock out, and they hand it off to Langford, looking for blocks on the edge. He's got a couple. He's got a crease down inside the 25-yard line. Stop it at the 26, and the clock will stop briefly to move the chains as Langford gets up limping.
Connor Cruz is out front. He's the center that's in for Jack Allen, who got kicked out of the game. Pretty good effort by him to lead him. Oh, he's 15, 20 yards downfield. How many times do you see a center in today's day of college football pulling around the edge for Jeremy Langford?
Look, that got him over the 100-yard marker. Yep. You mentioned the streak, and it goes to 9 straight conference games. Continues to be the longest streak for any FBS back in terms of 100-yard games within the conference. Nick Hill replaces him. And he's got it. Squirms for about 4.
Nebraska can't stop the clock unless the ball goes out of bounds, number one. Number two, at this point, Bo Pelini is telling his defense, guys, we don't have a timeout. It's the only chance we have. We got to knock that ball loose. And Michigan State's telling their running backs, hold on to the football no matter what happens.
They hadn't had a fumble loss this season until tonight. They've lost a couple. So you know they're going to aggressively punch and grab at that ball, whether it's Langford or Hill, and Pat Narduzzi's down on the field now, the defensive coordinator. This is Nick Hill again, bouncing it. Falls down after a 2-yard gain. It'll be third down inside of 2 minutes to play. And they can run it down just about a minute 20 when they snap it here in this next one. Did you think at the beginning of the quarter it was going to come down to Drummond trying to corral a dangerous onside kick?
No. I mean, Nebraska, what did they score, 19 here in the quarter? Yeah, 19 in the fourth quarter alone.
So one more first down pickup would seal it for sure here. And Langford is back in the game. And he's got it running left, but he's got no room to run. You got to stay in bounds. Gets knocked out of bounds to stop the clock. No flag as Gregory was chasing him out that way. You don't want to go out of bounds as a running back. It's fourth down.
And he's a senior and a veteran who's played a ton of football. And when he bounced that to the outside, I think he's thinking he's got a shot to get a first down. That's the only reason he would even go close to the sideline. But that's a mistake. And now Michigan State, because the clock stops, they're gonna kick a field goal.
So Geiger is out there. He's been perfect tonight. This to make it an 8-point game. They got to hurry. 5 on the play clock. This from 37. And he knocks it through, but now, oh no, it didn't go through. Off the upright and fell short.
Uh-oh.
And Nebraska, down by 5 with a minute 7 to go. A chance for a game-winning drive. That just hooked at the last minute. Looked like it was going through. Boink. But off now, the upright.
Yeah, now you've got a quarterback that's playing it with a whole different mentality in Tommy Armstrong. He's going to have to get, listen, you have no timeouts. Protection has been an issue. The most important thing is not taking a sack. The ball's got to get out of his hands quickly. He's got to find open people, and maybe they got to get first downs, and they got to get out of bounds because they can't stop the clock.
All those students who could have made noise, could have made it tough on the quarterback, they've all left a long time ago. Armstrong trying to get it out of the flat to Abdullah again. An inaccurate short throw. Calhoun is pressuring him.
And look at this. Look at this. If he show the play here where after Armstrong comes off of the play action, you'll see the running back, everybody's dropping. He dumps that. Look at the room that he's got to run. That's 15 or 20 yards and he's out of bounds.
Armstrong steps up, fires, far side, single coverage, caught made! Alonzo Moore into Michigan State territory. Can you believe it?
Keep in mind, Kenny Bell's out, others are stepping up. Alonzo Moore, the sophomore, and how about the throw by the gutty Tommy Armstrong down the right sideline? It's been a rough night. He continues to show great courage, sits in the pocket, and makes a great throw, maybe the best of the night.
43 yards. Are we going to see an absolutely stunning comeback here to cap a crazy weekend?
Timeout. Mark D'Antonio out on the field.
And spend another timeout on defense, their final timeout. Wow.
I mean, think about what Tommy Armstrong's been through tonight in this offensive line. He steps up. That's the same Ed Davis that's been chasing him all night. He steps up. He climbs in the pocket. And look at the coverage. The coverage is actually pretty good. He got a little bit of separation towards the end. Moore did, and pulling away from Waynes. But this ball could not be thrown any better. And a great job by a young sophomore who had five receptions coming into this game. With this, with the junior Kenny Bell out, it's been Jordan Westerkamp and now Alonzo Moore who have had to step up their game, and both have had their opportunities, and that time it's Moore.
Unbelievable.
This is crazy.
Turn of events.
Crazy.
Nebraska trying for a fourth quarter touchdown to absolutely, they haven't beat a top 10 team in the road since 97.
Right.
I mean, this would be one for the books.
Those students gave up on this game. You and I started
Absolutely.
To give up on this game. We're talking about other things.
Yeah.
The only people that didn't give up on this game, other than the fans back in the state of Nebraska, are Bo Pelini, his coaches, and those players.
37 yards away from a remarkable comeback. Armstrong pressured again, fires far side, looping throw, catch made, out of bounds. Moore caught it, but couldn't stay in.
Well, they found a guy that they want to get the ball to. They have two receivers very, very close to each other. Did he hold on to this football? I mean, almost, but that the fact that he got it, he just put his right hand up there.
He makes the catch.
Brown,
he goes down on the line. The ball flies,
that's
so
right.
Incomplete. 36 seconds to play. Armstrong in the pocket, intercepted. And Waynes, who was guilty of that controversial pass interference, makes his second interception of the night. A miscommunication, and the gutty comeback for Nebraska ends with 30 seconds to play.
Chris, a miscommunication with some inexperienced receivers. One that's trying to work here, freshman trying to go here. Watch how there's a little bit of confusion as they try to make the move. One to the inside, he gets in the way, and by doing that, Armstrong's completely anticipating Hubby coming across the middle, but he got caught up in traffic. He couldn't make his way across, and the ball is probably thrown on the money, but instead it falls into the hands of Trey Waynes.
Hubby ran into R.J. Williamson. Wayne's second pick of the night. They didn't finish like they wanted to. D'Antonio's team has to just barely hang on after leading 27-3 at one point in this game. Two guys with Youngstown, Ohio Road shake hands. Admirable fight to the finish by Pelini's team. But Michigan State just barely holds on by five.
Yeah, Michigan State gets a win. They're ranked in the top 10, and after all these losses, they're going to stay up in that area. But I walk out of this game probably more impressed.